This is the Northampton Conservation Commission meeting for the 15th of December, 2015. The commission is due to unpaid volunteers who work to protect the natural environment of Northampton. We are concerned with the eighth interest defined in the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act. Our duties also include open space acquisition and management. We operate in a way that's consistent with open meeting law requirements. All meeting dates, times, and agendas are posted in advance, and we invite public comment during our meetings. However, we ask the public to limit their comments to issues that are within our purview. Today's agenda includes a request for determination of applicability to determine if relocation of an underground drainage pipe is subject to the Wetlands Act or the Northampton Wetlands Ordinance. At the lumberyard at 256 Pleasant Street. Then a request for determination of applicability to determine if resource area boundaries are accurately delineated and if the area is subject to the Wetlands Act or the Wetlands Ordinance. This is on West Hampton Road. And then a notice of intent for installation of a stormwater outfall related to the Hinckley Street reconstruction project. This on Federal Street at Hinckley. Then a notice of intent for dam removal and stream restoration. Work to include within the riverfront of the Roberts Meadow Road, Chesterfield Road. And then some other administrative issues dealing with wilderness camping on Elwell Island, the review of mail and staff issue permits. We generally allow and invite public comment at two different times. One is general comments at the beginning of the meeting, and the other is case-specific comments during the hearing for that case. Should first let everybody know that we're being recorded audio or video, Sarah?
Both.
Okay. And are there any general public comments, not specific to any of the cases on the agenda? If not, first item is the approval of minutes, which Sarah sent around electronically. Those minutes were, Sarah, I'm trying to remember the date.
November 12th.
The only thing that occurred to me as I went through was that there's a point at which when we're discussing modifications to the city's wetlands ordinance language, it says we agreed to adopt them. I think we have to actually recommend their adoption, right?
That
should be modified. Any other amendments or modifications? Then is there a motion to approve minutes?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So voted. First item, this is a continuation. Request for determination of applicability to determine if the relocation of an underground drainage pipe is subject to the Wetlands Act. That's at the old Northampton Lumber site, 256 Pleasant Street.
Happy meeting. So, Wayne Biden, Office of Planning and Sustainability. So you've seen these plans before. Let me run through these quickly. So this plan, the orange of the road, so Pleasant Street, Holyoke Street. These are the two purple buildings that exist. This is the building the Valley CDC is planning to build. They've received the permits from Central Business Architecture and Planning Board. It's currently a very large brick sewer, 110-year-old brick sewer, that cuts through the site. That's this gray on this plan. And between the city and Valley CDC, we want to relocate it to allow this building to happen until everywhere goes underneath Holyoke Street. So the relocation would come across the railroad tracks where it does now. There'd be a new manhole. It would then be moved west where it currently is through eventually becomes Valley CDC's parking lot out to Holyoke Street and then come back to where it goes. There's some small laterals that serve these parking lots and buildings. They would be relocated to a new storm sewer that would hook into the line. I gather your first meeting was some discussion about the phasing. So typically when we do construction projects, we do the design and leave it to the contractor to do construction methods. But typically what happened is they're gonna build the whole line out here while this is still in use. And then just during the part where they're hooking in, they're pumped the storm sewer through here. But that's a relatively brief time. Most of the construction will be high and dry, and it's just when they actually break into the storm sewer on both sides, they have to pump the storm sewer through.
I'm trying to remember the last discussion, but it seemed that it was conceptually fine, but it wasn't enough detail, as I understand it, for us to feel like we could actually issue a permit without seeing more detailed construction details. Are those now available, those details?
So these are...
I know you're going to a contractor, so the actual digging and specifics number of days, all that sort of stuff is still...
So these are only construction plans that we have. It's sort of a catch-22 for us, frankly. We applied for what's called MassWorks, which is a grant program that we hope to build a portion of this, as well as a lot of traffic calming on Pleasant Street. We didn't get the grant this year, and one of the reasons we didn't get it is we weren't ready for permits. So we're trying to go through the process and getting the permits in a row. If anything changes, if the final design is different than this, then we understand we have to come back. But we think it's unlikely to change, that the plans on here are probably going to be the final plans.
Any of the other commissioners recall that, I'm trying to remember what was missing. We felt like we needed some more, and I'm just...
The question I have is, is the new building that's designed going to have a cellar or be deeper than this one? And why even go through the whole expense of...
Because it's brick, this is unreinforced masonry from 100 years ago. And so DPW wouldn't want a building, I mean, obviously, big cities have things on top of storm sewers, and we have a lot of those in town.
Yeah.
But not this sort of unreinforced masonry building, or, you know.
Another question, I think, in the discussion was that there was no information about the sizing of the pipes, how much stormwater flow there was, if it's adequate, and that by changing it, there's no information about how big they were relative to the load that they carried.
Okay.
And so, I mean, there was just not any kind of deed, it just said, here's what we want to do, but there was no information about movement of water, size of pipes, that big bend, if that big bend is if it's going to be an issue for movement of water,
so they
might back up.
Fortunately, I can't see it on here, but they are sized. So there is a size on here, and the plan, you may have made a better copy on what the size is. And I think your report also had the existing brick sewer. So there was it was last inspected 15 years ago or 20 years ago, and they walked through it. I don't think I was comfortable walking through it. So you should have a report in the application on what the existing sewer is. Mm-hmm. And Camp Dresser McGee did size this piece out here, 72 inches, so 6 feet in diameter. Mm-hmm. So that's what we're planning to do. And their assessment was, yes, it's adequate. Yeah. for carrying a load. So it's because it's round and it's more, so it's smoother pipe. Mm-hmm. Their assessment was this could carry all the water with the old pipe.
And the photographs from the last inspection, it looked like whoever the picture of the male inspector was couldn't stand up. So this is presumably a larger pipe than the existing pipe.
So the total volume is about the same or slightly larger. I think the old pipe may have been originally slightly taller, but because it's a brick sewer, it's not round. So the round pipe is... So
it has more square area.
It is more area, and also because it's new concrete as opposed to old brick. So when you're calculating the area, you're doing this coefficient of roughness, how rough is the pipe? Mm-hmm. And new concrete pipe is a lot smoother than brick pipe. So it actually carries a greater velocity of water. But we're limited, obviously, you know, to even if we want to carry more water through here, there's brick sewer downgraded and brick sewer upgraded. So there's no real benefit in making this pipe any larger and carrying more capacity.
Because we were concerned, is it going to be more restrictive and therefore risk backup upstream?
Right.
Or is it going to actually convey greater volume downstream? And if so, were there ripple effects, so to speak?
Right.
That we have to worry about. So there just wasn't the detail about the flows to be expected.
Right. So their calculations were this could carry all the water, so it's not going to do any backup. And because it's metered by the brick sewer up gradient, it doesn't matter if this
is going to increase.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm.
Is there a concern about that bend? I'm just imagining the flow of water. I'm curious. That sharp bend kind of makes it.
Right.
I mean, more than, yeah.
I'm not the engineer, so I can't tell you. CDM designed it, and they weren't concerned. I can pass it on, but I can't tell you the science behind that.
It does a lot of strange 90-degree bends before it gets to that point.
It does.
Yeah. Just looking at the map that's included in the...
Right. I mean, the sewer line is running right down the west side of Hawley Street. So the new building that's on Hawley Street, not so new anymore, Hampshire Education Collaborative, the reason it's set so far back from the street is because the sewer. And then it goes past their property and then takes a sharp right turn, sort of a, you know, 80-degree turn that's there. So yes, there's other sharp spots there. And there's already, you can see right here, there's already a fairly sharp end that's right here. It's an existing piece. But, you know, clearly you're right, this is going to be sharper here.
Other questions from the commission? Motion to close.
And then close.
Question?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
What do you think? I think you were the one who had initially given me.
Yeah, I just don't like the lack of detail. I don't have major concern, and also there's the fuzziness about what's our jurisdiction anyway, like how is it going to affect any of the resource areas? But since it's so far removed.
Well, and then it's,
and then
it's a stream. It just happens to be a pipe.
It's pipe, yeah.
So technically, it's, you know, you have jurisdiction over something that,
yeah, correct.
Most things don't, most of the rules don't seem to apply.
Directly around the stream, other than that. There's no riverfront area. It's too far from the exposed stream.
Mm-hmm. I think the logic that says that the amount of flow won't change that much because, no matter what, because upstream, there isn't going to change to the diameter and potential from that section of the place. So they can't really, as long as it's equal or greater, which is what the engineering folks attest to in terms of its carrying capacity, that it's going to back upstream and it won't have any additional flow downstream. Mm-hmm. So the logic is there, even if actual, you know, cubic feet per second numbers are not there.
Okay.
So I guess my sense would be that
there seems very little danger to the environmental impact, right. That would be a negative. I mean, it's already a degraded area, obviously, for the last 100 years.
One of the most degraded areas. So, yeah. Looking for so it at least will not alter any resource areas. So negative determination, checkbox 2, that the area is subject to the Wetlands Act but will not alter an area subject to protection. Somebody want to make that as a
move? Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So voted. Thank you, sir. Next item is request for determination of applicability to determine if resource area boundaries are accurately delineated in the area subject to the Wetlands Act or the Wetlands Ordinance. Applicant Craig Reese Wise from West Hampton Road.
So my name is Jesse Marinholm with Proterra Design Group. I'm here on behalf of the applicant and the owner. They're in the audience here. Craig Weiss is the applicant, and the current property owner is Dolores Weiss. So we're here tonight for an RDA to determine basically if the boundaries of resource areas here are accurate and to what extent they would be subject to the bylaw and act in town. It's an existing lot in the residential district. It's located in the southwest part of town. It's 80,000 square feet. It's kind of on the border of West Hampton, which is this way, and sort of East Hampton to the south. It's on West Hampton Road. It's right near house 1260. Really, we're between West Farm Road over here and Ridgeview. In the back here, there's a that Ridgeview subdivision kind of curls around the back here. So these boundaries were delineated in September and October of this year by Alec McLeod. There's two basic wetland series, A and B. One follows the Route 66, and one is set back a little bit. There is an outfall here on the adjacent property from the 2003 city alteration of Route 66, and that has some drainage that's contributing to that wetland. We're not in an ACEC. We are not in the floodplain, and we do not have habitat on our property, so we're clear there. And you know, we're not into the design process yet with the house. We're basically just here as a first step to take a look at these boundaries and make sure you folks are happy with the way they're depicted. That's really all I have.
Questions from commissioners?
Oh, it's the next phase. It's going to be difficult.
Yep, we certainly got our challenges ahead of us.
Yeah.
Again, first step in the process here. It's a funny shaped lot. You know, obviously the upland area we're trying to get to is back here. You look at kind of what's going on out there. This is sort of overlaid on a aerial, and you know, we're built up all around, or it's conservation land of the city of Northampton here. This is vacant land here, but this wetland continues down here. Actually some intermittent channels, and then eventually you end up in a Ham Brook down here. So
there's two parcels that make up this one?
Well, there's an existing parcel. It's about 77,000, and they're attempting to get to the current 80,000 limit, which is by zoning. That was the idea there. I think all the paperwork's done on that. I'm not sure if it's been approved yet, but that was the idea. We did continue it off under this property a little bit as well, in case this line should move, but it was really just to get that. I think we're going to be at 80,100 now.
Other questions?
I went to visit that site with Sarah, and you know, I'm still new on the commission, but it seemed that the markers that were in place lined up with what the wetlands on the ground, so you could see the logic of the layout of those designations.
And some of the plants that were used to delineate these were dead when they went out there. There was no jewelweed or ferns or anything, but you could pretty much tell from the tree canopy.
This is a fortunate year for that.
Yeah. No, definitely no snow.
Well, otherwise, we wouldn't be concerned.
Right.
Until spring.
All right. Motion, I guess we should ask. Anybody from the public have comments on this case? If not, motion to close.
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
As Sarah says in her write-up, no concerns. That we did indeed see the flags in case where protected zones are, and we can issue a positive determination by checking boxes 1 and 5 to indicate that the area is subject to the Wetlands Protection Act and the city ordinance, and 2A to confirm that the resource areas shown on the plans are accurate, but to note that any work that's actually going to be done will require a new application. We'll see you again.
Okay.
So is there somebody has a motion?
I'll move that.
And
somebody?
Sure.
Yeah.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? So moved. Next case is notice of intent for installation of stormwater outfall related to the Hickory Street reconstruction project in the middle of the New River. The applicant is Northampton DPW, the site is on Federal Street. So Sarah, who's?
Yes.
We're actually 1 minute ahead of schedule, so come on ahead. By that clock, by my clock, we're almost 3 minutes ahead of schedule. We can start by that. Pardon me?
Yeah. There's a diagram we placed up on the board. This is walking on the tripod.
I tested it this afternoon. It works. Let's see if it still works.
Well, it's the actual meeting. It's not going to work.
Can I just make a point of clarification? So the original document that was proposed is still the proposal, and then there's the additional alternatives letter that's 9 pages long.
Yeah.
Is there anything else I'm missing?
No.
But those are just the two things under consideration, right?
Am I allowed to vote on this?
Yes.
Okay, because I came in after the original plans were.
Yeah, so it's DPW will represent their full application, whoever we can vote.
If we had closed the hearing, then we would have been.
It's blinking. Okay, so next case, it is the appointed 5:55 time, so please introduce yourselves and go ahead. As Sarah said, we're expecting a complete submission again, so that all the current members can vote, because we've lost some members since the year originally.
Okay, great. Thank you. Good evening. I'm Jim Warla with the Department of Public Works. I'm the city engineer. I have with me Nicole Sanford. She's a senior environmental scientist, also with DPW. We're going to walk through this project, which involves the proposed construction of a new drainage outfall associated with the Hickory Street reconstruction project. We apologize for the delay in getting back. We were a little busy this summer with some things, so I'm trying to be responsive. And I replied to you, it was difficult to get the time to do that, but the original hearing was May 14th. We had a site visit on June 2nd. There was a supplemental memo that was submitted on July 21st, which provided some response to comments from the first hearing. And we had the second hearing on July 23rd. And we recently submitted some additional information and elaboration on alternatives. So what we're gonna do tonight is I'll talk about the project overview briefly. I'll have Nicole talk about the resource areas on the project site, and then I will talk briefly about the supplemental information that was submitted to the commission for consideration. The project is the full reconstruction of Hinckley Street. We're proposing new water, sewer, and drainage features, and some additional sidewalk and new paving on Hinckley Street. During the course of the project, we determined the need to repair and replace an existing outfall that was undersized and in a state of disrepair on the project site. The notice was filed relative to a proposed 36-inch diameter drainage outfall that we're proposing to take the drainage from Hickory Street and the surrounding area. It does replace a failed undersized drainage discharge in a nearby location. And the project also involves rerouting some stormwater from Upper Hinckley Street, Upper Warner Street, and Maplewood Terrace down Hinckley Street to the new outfall. So the existing outfall is a smaller 10-inch diameter outfall. The proposed outfall is a 36-inch diameter. The impetus for the new drainage outfall was in part driven by our desire to make some improvements to a long history of flooding problems on the Elm Street Brook area. It's an area where the city has had repetitive flooding problems through the years. We had a study that was done in 2012 by the firm Camp Dresser McKee in Cambridge, and they had outlined a plan that costed a tremendous amount of money to alleviate flooding in this area. It was to the tune of about $19 million. Much more money than the city has to fully address the flooding in the Elm Street Brook area. So when we were working on Hinckley Street, we identified some incremental improvements that we could do to reduce some of the impacts of flooding in the Elm Street Brook area by redirecting about 21.6 acres that goes up to Elm Street Brook along Elm Street, and that would be directed to the new drainage system, to the new proposed outfall. So the drainage improvements are in Hinckley Street and the new outfall geared toward reducing flooding in Elm Street Brook and also improving street drainage in Hinckley Street and the surrounding area. The new outfall, which is shown in the plan, I have it here. I can hold that up if you'd like. It's essentially, briefly, it's a 36-inch diameter pipe. There's four off-street manholes that cut across. Maybe I'll hold this plan up briefly. This is Riverside Drive here.
Just for the public, what is pointing to, his version is the same thing that's on the screen.
Okay. People are generally familiar with it, I think.
Anyway, you can't see it from here, but so the new drainage line, this is Riverside Drive, the new drainage line, there's four manholes that I showed. That we're using to reduce the slope of the pipe and the velocity of the discharge. So the pipes come around here, and then they angle into this 36-inch diameter flared end outlet here. We have a riprap discharge pad that's, I think, about 30 feet long. That's designed to reduce the energy, dissipate the energy from the discharge of the drain line. And also, the orientation also had to be such that it was aligned with an old canal that discharges to the Mill River. So that was the basic thought behind the way the pipes and the drainage discharge was designed. As part of the project, the existing 10-inch outfall that's in disrepair will be cut and capped in the street, and then that slope will be repaired as part of the project. So with that, I'll turn it over to Nicole to talk a little bit more about the resource area aspects of the project, and then I'll circle back and talk about the memos.
Sure. So just kind of to go over the administrative details, which we did back in May, but the NOI, as Jim mentioned, this project is part of a roadway reconstruction project, but it's really the outfall portion of the project, which is why we're in front of the Conservation Commission with the NOI. The roadway work really is outside of jurisdictional areas. And the structure, the proposed structure, is within 200 feet of the Mill River. So on this plan, the bank of the Mill River is shown in blue. Bordering vegetated wetland is shown in green. And then the offsets, so the riverfront area offsets associated with the Mill River, are shown in orange. So in terms of resource areas that are on the project site, as I said, there's bordering vegetated wetland, perennial bank associated with the perennial Mill River, intermittent bank, and it's this intermittent bank which is really just jurisdictional under the Northampton Ordinance and not the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act. There's also another isolated wetland, again, no jurisdiction under the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, but under the Northampton Ordinance. So the project meets the limited project provisions of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act related to routine maintenance of road drainage structures. It's not necessary really to claim limited project status, as the project can meet all the performance standards for the resource areas that it's impacting. Original certificates of mailing were given back in the the first meeting in May. And DEP did issue a file number. They had one comment, not really related to Mass Wetlands Protection Act, it was related to the Federal Clean Water Act and the Mass General Permits. That process is completed. DPW did prepare a pre-construction notification, or a PCN, and coordinated with the forum, we have received approval on the project as proposed. So the delineation was done in July 10th of 2014. And we had the site visit on the 2nd, so I know the commission is aware of how altered the riverfront area is down here with existing bike jumps and such. So this bordering vegetated wetland and then this intermittent drainage channel here was formerly part of a canal associated with a mill complex on Federal Street, but it obviously no longer functions as a canal. And over time, you know, whether it's just erosion or fill that's happened here, the canal is separated, and BVW is located to the east, and then this intermittent drainage channel is located to the west. So in terms of impacts associated with the project, there will be 710 square feet of temporary impacts to the bordering vegetated wetland in this area, and that's just really due to the use of timber mats for the contractor to stage equipment in order to grade the road in this area. Again, that's temporary impact. So it meets the performance standards for working with the bordering vegetated wetland, because once the work is done, there will be no permanent alteration or fill to the wetland. It will be restored in kind. In terms of the intermittent bank impacts, again, there's no impacts to bank associated with the perennial Mill River. It's just intermittent bank. And the bank impacts here are 45 linear feet of temporary impact associated with the installation of the erosion control barrier, and then 25 linear feet of impact associated with some grading in this area to grade the area associated with the installation of the outfall. So when you work within bank performance standards under the Mass Wetlands Protection Act for perennial bank involved, or jurisdictional bank rather, involve no impact to the physical stability of the bank, the water carrying capacity of the bank, the ground and surface water quality of the bank, and the breeding habitat, escape, cover, food for fisheries. So the very nature of this project is in keeping with the performance standards for working within bank. The existing, as I've shown you, the existing outfall is, actually I didn't show you that, I'm sorry, the existing outfall is up here and it drains to the intermittent bank. So, like I said, the existing outfall drains to this channel, and the new outfall will be an improvement over existing conditions. The purpose of the outfall is to dissipate energy during storm events and to prevent downstream erosion. So for that reason, it will be maintaining the physical stability of the existing bank. The water carrying capacity of the channel will not change. The channel carried water from the existing outfall, and it will continue to do that after construction of the new outfall. And the intent of the outfall is to protect the ground and surface water quality of the bank, especially during high storm events. And the new outfall will be an improvement over existing conditions, as this area is really degraded, is falling apart and causing embankment erosion. And as I said before, the area is highly altered. It functions as a drainage channel. There was no flow at the time of delineation. I don't think there was any flow in that drainage channel when we were out there during the site visit. There's not much vegetation, you know, like shrub vegetation along that drainage channel bank. So for those reasons, the impacts associated with the construction of outfall, it's not likely to impact breeding habitat or escape cover or food for fisheries. And the permanent bank impact associated with the project is less than 10%, or is below the 50 linear foot threshold for requiring a wildlife habitat analysis. So we don't, there's no need for that because we don't meet that threshold. So the next resource area would be riverfront area. And the majority of the project really is in riverfront area. It's actually within the outer riparian zone of riverfront area. There is about 200 square feet of impact associated with the grading. That's right here in the inner riparian zone. But again, the majority of the work is in the outer riparian zone. And the total amount of that impact is 19,380 square feet. And just another point of clarification, the notice of intent was filed under new development and not redevelopment. The site really doesn't meet the definitions of developed riverfront area, and that's really because the existing outfall is outside of riverfront area. And even though the area is absent of topsoil, those bike jumps, from our understanding, were built in 2013. So they weren't built prior to 1996. So for that reason, we filed this as a new development and not previously developed riverfront area. So Jim's going to talk more about the alternatives and the memo that we just recently submitted to the Conservation Commission. But I'll talk a little bit about the no significant impact performance standard, which requires a minimum of 100-foot wide undisturbed vegetation, stormwater compliance, and that the project does not impact wildlife habitat functions or groundwater or surface water quality. So again, the majority of the impact is within the outer riparian zone. And like I said, there's really only 200 square feet of impact in the inner riparian zone. The project does meet the stormwater regulations, and CDM was in here in May and went over the stormwater report, which was submitted as part of the notice of intent. And then within 200-foot riverfront areas, the Conservation Commission may allow the alteration of up to 5,000 square feet or 10% of the riverfront area within a lot, whichever is greater. The regulations also say that structural stormwater management structures can be excluded from those calculations as long as there's no alternative to citing those on site. But we did include those calculations, and even when you include those calculations, the impact associated with this is 3% of the riverfront area that's on the project site.
And that includes the outflow pipe and the road and the embankment that would be riprap?
Yeah, that includes all of this area. So as I discussed with the new performance standards, the intent of the new outfall really is to protect the ground and surface water quality of the bank area, especially during high storm events. And the new outfall will be an improvement over existing conditions. So
sure. So after the first hearing, there was considerable public comment and concern about the project. There were many questions that were asked. We took copious notes, and the commission asked us to provide some responses to questions that were raised in the hearing. And we did that in a memo dated July 21st. We elaborated on some of the reasons why we selected the site for the outfall. And talked about the alternative, which was basically to rebuild the existing smaller diameter outfall, which didn't meet the project goals and objectives of helping to reduce flooding in Elm Street Brook. We had a little bit of discussion about the access road and why we were proposing to build an access road and keep it and not remove it. There was considerable concern about the construction of the access road and the width of it, and our desire to leave it there for our operation and maintenance for the culvert, the drainage system, and potential repairs. We had a lot of discussion in the meeting about how that access road might be used and types of equipment we might need for that access road. And we tried to document that in the memo a little bit with photos of the types of equipment that might be necessary for repairs. We talked a little bit about the types of conditions where we might need to get down there to the new drainage outfall. There were other brief sections in the memo responding to questions about the general need for access to outfalls, some questions about water quality concerns associated with the project, whether low impact development options were considered, replanting options, whether it's a proposed gravel road, whether there was any consideration for an alternative road surface, And then we provided more detail in terms of the flow, the reduction in flow to the Elm Street Brook. So we were stating in the first meeting that it was important to us to reduce some of the storm flows to Elm Street Brook. We hadn't quantified that in the notice of intent. We went back and asked CDM to do some calculations for us. And they had identified a 25-year storm that 25.9 cubic feet per second of water that would go to the Elm Street Brook would be going down the proposed outfall. That was about a 6.9% reduction in flow to the Elm Street Brook. And for a 100-year storm, it was about a 4.7% reduction in flow to the Elm Street Brook. So we should try to provide a little more detail on that. We just recently submitted a memo dated December 9th to the commission, which provided additional detail on the outfall options. Still a fair amount of concern from the public in the second hearing about the proposed project and the road, and we were asked to look at other outfall options, and we framed the discussion of the options in the way that's required by the Wetlands Protection Act regulations. We tried to be true in our analysis and how information was presented so that we were hitting the criteria that were required by the Wetlands Protection Act and hopefully responsive to the commission. So we started by talking about the project purpose, which is to mitigate flooding to Elm Street Brook, improve street drainage in Hinckley Street, and replace an existing undersized failed outfall. So the memo was framed in meeting those project purposes. And as Nicole had just summarized, we compared the existing project to performance standards in terms of the impacts of the project, and also had the same conclusion that we had in the notice of intent filing, which was that the project meets the definition of no significant adverse impact as defined in the regulations and the types of alterations that are allowed under the Act. In the third section of the memo, we went into discuss four alternatives in terms of trying to determine whether they were practicable, substantially equivalent economic alternatives as defined in the regulations. The regulations require that costs, use of technology, proposed use, and logistics be reviewed as the criteria when you're considering options. We looked at, the first option was just simply replacing the existing 10-inch outfall, and we essentially ruled that out because it doesn't improve the street drainage on Hinckley Street, it doesn't mitigate flooding in Elm Street Brook. So that option was dismissed. The second option was regarding the Elm Street Brook master plan proposed by CDM to improve and prevent flooding along Elm Street Brook. And that was ruled out because of the very high cost and the fact that it would help Elm Street Brook if we did that huge project, but it actually wouldn't help with Hinckley Street, which is the project that we're doing right now. So it wouldn't improve Hinckley Street drainage, and it wouldn't replace the failed 10-inch culvert. But was put more in there just in terms of a sense of scale of the type of problem that the city faces in this area and why we feel that this project is an important one. The third option was basically the plan as designed with a temporary access road where we would remove the access, there's an access road that's needed for construction, and we would remove that construction road at the end of the project. And I described how that would be done by basically reducing the slope from Riverside Drive down to the lower part of the road, which is sort of grade across that. And the point there, I think, was that the total amount of disturbance would be the same whether we keep the road or whether we remove the road. And so what it mainly does is it adds cost to the project for the city to do the project, and then if we ever needed to do any repair on the drainage system, we would have to spend more money to reestablish the road and would be back in front of the commission seeking approval to do that. So we ruled out using a temporary access road and doing something else with that. We ruled out that option number three. And then option four, for discussion purposes, it was basically the same plan with a 36-inch outfall with a 10-foot wide road. And there was a lot of discussion about the road width in previous meetings, which is why I wanted to include this. But again, the conclusion was that the resource area impacts are the same. And if we leave the road just a narrow width, the road may not fully form, it may not, it's not as safe, basically, if we put a narrower road in. We're proposing a 14-foot wide road. If we make it narrower, it makes it a little bit less safe, depending on the type of equipment we need to get down there. It doesn't reduce the resource area impacts. That was sort of our review of the alternatives, and we have carried forth the alternative that we proposed originally for those reasons. We provided some additional information. I think we've tried to take all the comments serious, and I realize that we have the proposal that we had at the beginning, but I think we've tried to be true to the process and listening to what things people have said in these meetings. We provided some additional information in the December 9 memo regarding sort of a comparable project that was brought to our attention at Smith College at the end of Paradise Road. There was a replacement outfall that was built there this summer that was approved by the commission. We did go back and look at the plans. That project had required approval by the department for a stormwater permit previously, but we went back. We looked at the plans to see what the project was and if there was something there that could help us in how we designed and were planning to do this project. And I guess to summarize our findings, it was a little smaller project. It was a 15-inch diameter outfall. It was a very steep slope that was leading down to the Mill River. No road was proposed by Smith College in order to build that new outfall. But access was available. There's an existing sewer easement that runs along the toe of the slope. So the contractor was able to build key components of the outfall because they had access from the bottom of the slope and they had access from the top of the slope. So to better understand what happened on that project, we found out that the contractor for that project was Gielher Enterprises. We invited them into our office for a meeting. We had a meeting in our office to talk to them about how they went about building the outfall for the Smith College project, and they described the equipment that they used and that it was very important that they had access from that sewer easement at the lower elevation where the outfall discharge is. And they said that if they didn't have the easement that they would have needed to build the road from the top, something comparable to what we're proposing in this project. When we had Gielher in our office, we also asked them to take a look at the plan for Hinckley Street. When we showed them the outfall plan and just sought their input in terms of how they would go about constructing the project, and we didn't say anything about discussions here or the status of the conversations we've been having with the commission, but the contractor did say you need an access road to get to the bottom in order to build the outfall, in order to build the riprap outlet. And he also said you're going to want to keep that road in case you ever need to maintain it or repair it. And we didn't really pressure him or tell him what the issues were that we were talking about, but he offered that as his opinion. So I presented that in the memo. And then the last thing was there was some flooding along Elm Street Brook September 30th. You may recall it was a fairly intense rainstorm that we received, and the city had to close Elm Street because of that storm for a time. There were some photos in the Gazette that we published, that we downloaded, and we put them into the memo to show that the flooding along Elm Street Brook is going to be a recurring event, and we do feel like it's part of our job at the Public Works Department to identify where there are problems and do the best we can with the resources we have to make improvements for the city. And this project with a new 36-inch diameter outfall in this location, I feel is an important improvement for the city. And for those reasons, at the end of the memo, we were again requesting project approval because we believe it complies with the Wetlands Protection Act and also that it's an important project for the city. So that was kind of the end of the most recent additional information. We're happy to try to answer any questions that you have.
Questions from commissioners? What's the minimum necessary maintenance that you expect over time? And what sort of equipment is minimally necessary to perform?
Well, I think We'd indicated previously that routine maintenance, there may not be a lot that needs to be done. We'll probably check to make sure that the outlet from the discharge is clear, that we don't have woody debris or things in the canal that would prevent water from flowing to the Mill River. So that could be something with a, depending on the amount of debris, it could be a small, truck with men with shovels, that sort of thing. So nothing too great. I think the real need for larger equipment, whether it's a backhoe or an excavator or a dump truck, would be necessary if there was some sort of failure or significant damage to the drain line itself. I don't know what caused that damage, but if we needed to rebuild any section of the drain line in the location where it is because of some sort of erosion that happened in a major storm event or some other failure event that we can't predict, we would need to get in there with bigger equipment that would be comparable to the equipment that the contractor would use to build it. So that might be a larger excavator and a dump truck with material. It could be riprap or gravel or some other kind of material. So more frequent use of the road would be for smaller equipment, and then the road would be there if there was a need to get larger equipment down there for some sort of failure reason.
I have a question about that here, 3% calculation. So it says you can, what is the total area that you're considering in that 3%? It's about the lot size, right? It's
right.
It's the lot size.
So I don't have the acreage for the lot size, but I can tell you that the number I used was 783,000 square feet of riverfront area on the lot. And of that, 19,380 square feet is being impacted, which is roughly 3%.
So that's the entire lot that's owned by the property owner? Yeah, just when looking at the site itself, you know, that
the parcels,
the actual, you know, disturbed area seems much, much greater because we're just considering this area. But if you include someone owned half of the neighborhood and this is just a small area, then it's a tiny little percentage. So I don't know, I have a hard time, and we're considering the disturbance to this one small area, and I have a hard time having that be compared with it. But I understand that that's what the regulation is. I just want to put that in perspective.
Sure. You know, one other thing I meant to mention during my discussion is that there's been a lot of disturbance at the site since the commission did their site walk. Nicole and I were out at the site today, taking a look around in order to prepare for tonight's hearing. And there's been a lot more disturbance because of bike jumps and other excavation and things that have happened since June. It was a little alarming to me to see the degree and the nature of the disturbance. We're doing our best to comply with the Act and to do things in a sound way and to protect the site to the best that we can and accomplish the project goals. And when we were out there, we saw just a heck of a lot of disturbance and excavation. We provided some photographs to Sarah earlier today that showed the nature of the activity, and it extends well beyond the disturbance that's happened recently. Extends well beyond the project limits in terms of impact to the resource area. So we were a little bit concerned about that, and we sent some photos, and we just wanted to be aware of.
Yeah, I visited again this summer, and I was a little concerned about it coming back over and over again.
Right.
On that note, what do you plan to do in terms of improving the conditions of the site as a result, as a part of the project? You were talking about in the current outfall. You're going to cap off and then stabilize the bank.
Right, so the bank is sort of a mess there if you've been out there.
Yeah.
We're gonna backfill and stabilize the slope, and then that areas that are steeper will be stabilized with riprap. But our work limits are pretty much as shown on the plan. Some of the disturbance that's happened that Sarah was just showing on the photos up there extend beyond the areas that we were going to disturb as part of the project.
Yeah.
Some of the disturbance that's happened is within the project area, and those areas would be modified if the project moves forward in terms of, you know, the design, but...
Other questions from commissioners? Have we got any communication with the property owner about the additional rather industrious work of...
We haven't. I wasn't aware about it until today. So just for some background, the commission did do an enforcement order, I think it was about a year and a half ago, and the neighborhood did a cleanup, but it seems like the bike jumps.
And the only...
Pretty industrious.
Person who can deliver such an enforcement order to is the property owner, even though he didn't have any to do with the bike jumps, et cetera. We were unaware that they've been continued to get even more impressive, it looked like, than those things.
So my understanding of that, of this project, is that you're going through with this NOI and then having discussions with the property owner about the project, or is there an agreement that it's going to happen?
We have had discussions with the property owner, and the city does have an easement to do the project now.
Okay, there is an easement.
That was my question.
Was there any discussion with the property owner about restriction of access to the site? I mean, that could be potentially an issue that if the property continues to be disturbed, that the property owner might need to restrict access.
In terms of the scope of our project, no, we didn't discuss restricted access.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about the road in particular. If there's a concern about folks using that and overusing it, then it might have to be restricted in some way.
We were only going to restrict the road by a cable or a gate at the top to prevent any vehicular, unauthorized vehicular activity. We didn't really want to talk about restricting access to the site because, as far as I can tell, a lot of people cross that site to get to the river. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we didn't really feel it was in our purview to necessarily to do that. So we didn't really approach the property owner about it. And, we're just trying to accomplish the outfall and maybe other goals that need to be accomplished on that property. We didn't feel, we didn't have those discussions.
It seems that there's, the property has been regarded as public by a lot of the neighbors, by the kids who built the bike lanes. And I don't know whether, without changing that fundamental assumption, I don't know, having a nice road to walk down instead of paths to walk down, I don't know if that's going to change much.
What's the proposed road surface again?
It's gravel. Yeah, compacted gravel. It's dangerous to walk down there right now. We almost lost the city engineer on this little sidewalk this morning. So I don't know how some of the neighbors make it down, but during the sidewalk, even it was pretty difficult.
I want to tell you that I appreciate the alternative analysis that you've done. That's what I would have wanted earlier on, but now that you've done it, it's much clearer to kind of go through the logic that was involved in the development process. So I really appreciate this last submission.
The memo from last week was quite useful. I was the one who suggested to Jim that he take a look at the Smith project because I brought it up here and I thought, oh, that might be a solution. And I think the answer is yes, it might be a solution, but it would also require the construction of the road. It would be a different path for the outfall itself, but it's not a substantially different impact.
No.
Other comments, questions?
I'm still wondering how the road can be constructed and not affect that 54 and a half foot diameter oak.
The big oak?
Yes.
About 54 feet.
The road is right
54 inch
right next to here. There's going to be cutting into the bank. I'm not sure how it's going to affect the root system, and then there's all sorts of fill on the other side of it, so it's, I don't know how it's going to remain. Any talks or any considerations for replanting when you get this project done, or if you get the project done?
Well, we didn't have any plans to do replanting. We have had discussions with the tree warden about the large tree, and we recognize the difficulty in trying to save it. And I think I said in a previous meeting, we're not guaranteeing that we'll be able to save it, but we want to work with the contractor to see what we can do. To see what we can do there. The tree is, the ground is all disturbed around the trunk of that tree now, and it's been even more disturbed because of the recent activity out there on the site. So I'm sure the work that we're doing won't help it any further. But
oh, okay.
Will shade tree hearings be needed for any of those removal stuff?
People from the public.
Well, if there are no more questions, not that you've exhausted your opportunity, you can come again later. But are there members of the public who have any comments?
We haven't
heard
before. Sure. Hello. Could I introduce myself?
Sure, please.
My name is Fred Bedall, and I'm a resident of 26 Liberty Street. And thanks for the opportunity to comment. I realize I'm coming in late to the process. Very good information to hear, but I am familiar with the site from multiple visits, apparently illegally, but what we do in the neighborhood. Well, I also have a hat that I just wanted to wear just for a moment, even though it's rude inside. It says Connecticut River Watershed Council, mm-hmm. which we're members. And I'd just like to bring up, from first comment, is the watershed perspective. And I appreciate the civil engineering perspective about, you know, move the water off as fast as possible. But the watershed protection perspective, which I'm sure your Conservation Commission is well aware of and agrees with probably, is that you actually want to slow down the movement of stormwater off of the streets and into the river and the watershed rather than speed it up. And so in that case, this project actually is moving in the opposite direction in terms of improving the watershed quality by taking a 10-inch outflow pipe, which is in fact functioning to the degree that there's water coming out of it today, and there's sort of a lake down on the floodplain. And increasing that to 36 inches and moving it closer to the riverbank. So it also, as we all, you folks probably know, and is a source of non-point water pollution. The stuff that comes down with the storms through the storm drain is actually, you don't want to put it into the creek. But, you know, we're going to be expediting that process rather than slowing it down and remediating it by doing this. And it also, the tree, I do have to mention something about this tree. That is a pretty spectacular tree, and I just have a little aid here for anybody who's forgotten how big 54-inch tree is. That is the size of this tree. And the road is to be, as you mentioned, sir, right up against the tree and then going 14 feet into a bank, which is already very steep and erosive. And it really is hard to see. I mean, it is apparent that that would kill the tree. But also, if I might just point this out over here, and this, you may have already heard this point a million times, but, excuse me, this extremely steep slope, by putting a 14-foot road in here, and this is one of the wetlands areas, is right down in here, it's just hard to see how that slope is not going to be destabilized during that process and forever after by the amount of grading that's going to be necessary to put a road right through there. So, I guess I would just finish by saying that this area, despite it not being a public area, is a huge community asset and focus of public love of the Mill River and recreation there. And I admit that the bike people, you know, sort of tolerate youth doing things that maybe are not environmentally benign. But I've seen people of all ages swimming in the river down there. And, you know, this is like, to have this turned into a place which has also got what most people will see as a sewage outfall pipe in it, it's going to significantly degrade a place which is really a very beloved asset of this community. And that pipe, by the way, is that's the kind of structure which is going to invite perhaps some of the same kids who like to do the bike jumps with spray cans to put graffiti on the concrete surfaces. And also that the structure itself could be inhabited by skunks, rats, various other things that will want to live in a big 36-inch pipe. And all that in an area of a lot of public use. So I think there's no question to me that it's going to degrade that area of the Mill River pretty significantly. I mean, that's not the end of the world. It's just another little thing, but it's a sad thing to me as somebody in the neighborhood who thinks that it's a pretty special place. And thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Alex?
Hi, yes, Alex Gieselin, 164 Riverside Drive. And I want to start by really thanking the Conservation Commission for the process that you guys have gone through. And the concern and particularly the site visit. I don't think you can vote on this project without having visited that site and get an idea of the scale of what the DPW plans to do. I've not heard any estimates of the amount of fill that are going to be brought into that wetlands and into that fairly sensitive area for a permanent road. And the point's well made that we're concentrating road runoff, the kind of not the major storms, now I'm talking about everyday rain events, bring contaminated water down to a specific point. It's better than dumping it directly into the river that the federal government won't let us do and the state nobody would let us do. But contaminating the riverbank doesn't seem to me a large step forward. But the larger question in my mind, or hope that I have, is that this is really the beginning, that the enactment of the stormwater fee gives the DPW the resources to really address stormwater problems in the city, which have been accumulating for 25, 30 years. So this is going to come up over and over again, and I really hope that the Conservation Commission will be part of the process of pushing the DPW to look for greener solutions. I remember in the storm mitigation plan process that we saw a lot of documents, a lot of advice from the federal government on how to build roads that disperse stormwater, don't concentrate it. So, in my opinion, the scale of this project is so large that a 3 to 5% decrease in huge flood events is not worth it. Opinions are easy. Decisions with consequences are not. But this seems not the place to have the ideological conversation or the long-term conversation, but somewhere else, that with the DPW, the Conservation Commission, environmental part of the city really needs to get together and look at what other cities are doing, what other countries are doing, because we're about to spend an awful lot of money on our stormwater. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Sir.
My name is John Norton. I live at 39 Winslow Avenue, which is the upstream end of the drainage project. And recently, my wife and I spent $60,000 to keep our basement from being part of the slowdown of the water, the underground water, not water from the street level, but the water that exists in Baker Hill as underground water. And some of that water in this plan, this excellent plan of the DPW, is going to take that underground water and take it from coming into not only our basement, but basements all along Winslow Avenue. And that water will be drained into the underground system, whether it's raining or not, because it's there all the time. And it will go downstream. Now, I recognize that we don't want oily water, water from the street, salt water, all those kinds of water from surface area draining down into the river. And we certainly don't want it going under the high school field and flooding the people down there. But in my view, the city, when I went down there and heard their description of what they're trying to do, and it seemed like they were trying to do the best they could with the money they had to slow the water down. And one of the things about that site that I noticed was that the water is going to drain, planned to drain upstream, But the canal, the old canal, also goes downstream and joins the river down there. Now, if there's a heavy, heavy storm, the river is going to rise, and all that area will be flooded. And the water that's draining from the street at that time will be in that flooded area. I guess that's about all I have to say, that upstream we have a different view of what this plan is going to do for the city.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Mary Clark. I live at 183 Riverside. And I also have comments from my neighbor, Jason Smith, at 185 Riverside, which he texted me because he's out of town. So my own comments, I really appreciate being back and hearing some of the alternatives. I've been at some of the other hearings. I was disappointed not to hear an alternative that involved replanting. I understand that that has been mentioned frequently in the comments, and I was saddened that that had not been brought to the table with any of the alternatives. So I still leave with a question of what does that mean? Does that mean that the Bay State Village Association tries to take over replanting? Does that mean that we're charged in some other ways as a village community? Does that mean that we don't have any opportunity to replant? And so I bring that to you as a question that I feel has not been sufficiently answered. And I also want to bring up again the idea that while I understand from an engineering perspective that it would make no sense to put in a temporary road, that's simply the engineering perspective. From the perspective of someone who lives there and uses that area, to me, a temporary road makes an enormous amount of sense. And I just think that that option needs to stay on the table. From my neighbor, Jason Smith. Jason Smith, I believe his number is 185, but essentially, if you've been on the site, he's a little yellow house with a white picket fence, and his driveway, if you went out of his driveway, you'd just drive and turn and go right down the road. And he has said to me, Mary, I can't go to the meeting, please will you speak, that I am concerned, I have an 18-month-old child, and am concerned about the increased possibility of people using a more permanent road, bikers, etc., at that area. And I please state that I am in favor of a temporary road and understand that they need to be able to build this road, but that please have a temporary. So those are Jason's comments.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Sure. My name is Jeff Dawson from 89 Federal Street. First of all, I'm kind of surprised that 7 months later we're still looking at the same plan and the same NOI. I find that just kind of surprising. I'd also like to say that just a couple things that were mentioned over the discussion tonight. While it is a 17-plus acre parcel, the factory itself at 122 Federal Street is being sold as an 8-acre property, so I don't know if that's after the sale or what that does to your numbers, but I'd just like to point that out. I'd also like to say that while all these trees are being removed, they're really effective water storage tanks. And so this is to do with stormwater, and yet we're going to get rid of the water storage capacity on the site as it exists. Also, I would just like to say that while the area is considered degraded because of the earthen bike jumps that we've tried to work with the Conservation Commission on removing out of the wetland area, I would much rather see those than a half acre of riprap being replaced. And I'd also just like to point out that while there's not a lot of understory, it's primarily due to the canopy that exists that's going to be removed and not replaced. There's no mitigation plan, there's no planting plan, and also it just does not make sense that there's no way of using any kind of low impact development or even replacing the riprap with like native rounded boulders. I think there's still a lot of holes in this, and it's a little disheartening that the same thing just keeps coming back. And I understand that it might be well engineered, but I think it's kind of strange that contractors have looked at the plan, but landscape architects haven't. Seems to me there's a missing page to this plan, and that should really be addressed, and it's setting a very bad precedent. And I also just don't think it meets riverfront standards.
Thank you.
Sir, briefly, we usually allow one try, but go ahead.
As far as the degradation of the bank, one of the reasons it's degraded is because people slip and slide down a very steep slope. I have a nervous condition which is causing me to lose mobility on my feet, and the road, unlike some people feel about it, I feel it would be an access for me, because it would be a slope that is passable for people with handicaps.
Thank you. If nothing else, motion to close. Or do we want to add more based on that input, more questions?
Yeah, no, I think I have a couple more questions.
Good.
Yeah, I'm trying to formulate them in my head. Because, I mean, overall, I have similar concerns that, you know, the one question I had is, have you guys changed your plans at all as a result of this public process? Because I feel the same way, that you presented us with a plan, and then you stuck to the plan, and you provided more evidence on why the plan should work. And I'm not sure whether there was that. You know, ideally in this type of process, there would be some give and take. Are there places where you have changed your plans as a result of the process?
There are not.
I ask whether these proposed manholes are deep sunk, and are there any storm scepters that are going to be required to clean up the water before it hits the outfall?
All the manholes on the project are deep sump manholes, but there's no storm scepter type of equipment being used as part of the proposal. We're restricted a little bit. I guess I don't want to respond to all these comments, because we'll be here all night and we have a lengthy thing coming.
Yeah.
But we're not opposed to replanting. I think, you know, the steepness of the slope predicates the use of armoring. And whether we can successfully get anything to grow in the steep slope with armoring is pretty questionable. And I think eventually, because of the erosion, actually it's a little alarming if you go out there now, because of the erosion of the slope along Riverside Drive, if we never did this project, we'd probably be back in front of you with an armoring project to stabilize the road, because that's just a really bad condition out there on the site right now. So the work that we're doing, and people are concerned about the riprap, and I can appreciate that. But just in terms of stabilizing Riverside Drive, it's something that needs to be done. And those are, you know, some other benefits we haven't talked about. But there's a need to stabilize that area.
But in between planting and riprap, there are other options. There are maps of various kinds. There are approximations of that enable natural stabilization. Have those been considered?
They haven't, mainly because they would add a lot of cost to the project.
And similar question with the desirability of cleaning the water. You mentioned there's no storm scepters, so there's deep sump manholes, but no devices that actually intentionally slow and clean particulates or whatever out of the flow. Was that considered?
We felt that we met the stormwater standards to the best extent that we could for a redevelopment project, and that was adequate for the project to be approved. So we didn't include storm scepters. They're very expensive structures, and they weren't proposed, obviously, as part of the project. That was described in the stormwater report when we discussed the stormwater standards.
Also, we've been moving towards trying to have artificial wetlands at outfalls. Was the velocity of the water in this project such that that wouldn't be feasible?
Yeah, I don't remember what the velocity is, but we needed to have a 30-foot long riprap splash pad at the outlet to reduce the velocities down. So there would be pretty good velocities coming out of there. The idea is to get them down to the point where they're not erosive as the water enters the canal.
say more about, you thought about an artificial wetland?
Yeah, at the outfall instead of the riprap, which is an option in some cases, but it doesn't work very well with just really high velocity.
If there's that much force coming out of it, it's just not going to get a chance to get established. And how much of one of the public comments involved the amount of fill that's going to be required to construct the road? Has that been estimated? How many yards per meter?
I don't know how many yards it is. We could determine it if you want to know the number, but I don't know how many yards. The access road's about 150 feet long. I think what was remarkable to me today when I went out there is the level of disturbance in this riverfront area based on these bike jumps and the work that these kids have done is twice as much probably than we're going to do as part of this project. We're trying to do the best we can. We don't have unlimited resources to accomplish these improvements for the city.
Part of the consideration that I think we have to wrestle with is what do we define as an area to be improved? Is it quite local within the outfall that's being proposed, or does it include the Elm Street Brook area as part of the same network of protected areas? This is not a simple proposal. Other questions, comments, information? Sarah, do I understand that once we close the hearing, we are more limited in terms of what we can ask the applicant to
That is correct. So we could include conditions that may include revised plans and things like that, but the discussion tonight would end.
Yeah. Because that's a preliminary discussion to determine whether we ought to close the hearing and say, okay, we're going to rule on this application, and now we may try to issue orders of condition that address, assuming we approve it, that address our concerns, or we could ask the applicant to more specifically address certain concerns. Like additional information about the amount of fill, what natural or more nearly natural stabilization techniques might be used, et cetera.
But I guess, you know, I'm just struck with how, as much as the city could spend more dollars to try to do plantings, et cetera, which I think are necessary, I also am concerned if there's going to be continued degradation in other areas, which is, I think, a separate issue to this. But that's, I'm sort of struggling with how do we balance the needs or the desires of the community, which are, you know, understandable, to the entire city, to really the environment. It's a tough one.
Right. I guess my inclination is to close the hearing and rule on the application we've got in front of us. We've asked in the past, and the applicant has come back with arguments about why the existing application is the best they can come up with. So
so I'm not sure that asking them to go back to the drawing board and figure out additional alternatives is going to change much. So I guess my suggestion is we close the hearing and rule on this application. Mm-hmm. I guess the chair can make a motion to that, I guess. I'll make a motion. Chair should.
Someone
not. Is there a motion to close the hearing?
Okay, move to close the hearing.
Second.
Made and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The hearing is closed. So we have an application in front of us about which we do not feel entirely comfortable. I was uncomfortably persuaded that the plan that I had hoped would be a more minimally intrusive solution would require, in the end, the same road construction and the same fundamental issues as this application involves. So I think it's what I have come down to as I've listened and read through all this stuff is that if we look at this as a very local impact, it is, I haven't been out there in recent weeks, but I was out there for the site visit in once since, and the sort of gully that's getting carved down the street is definitely going to undermine Riverside at some point. It's already taking a lot of the hillside away. This is a very steep area. As long as you've got a human population and you need to put the water from the street somewhere, it's going to go to the existing river system, and so the existing outfall is problematic. Does this application narrowly improve this relatively few acres right around the work area? I can look at that and argue either way. On the other hand, if I think of it as connected to responsibility evaluating whether it benefits other parts of the river system, including the Chelmsford Brook and the flooding there and so forth, then I probably would come on the side, yeah, those have some good net benefits to the resource areas for which we have responsibility and jurisdiction. So I end up going back and forth. But
is that considered an improvement in this case? I mean, because we're not really supposed to be considering outside of this area, but yet they're coming to us with an application with the logic that they need to reduce the Elm Street flooding. So I'm a little bound by that, but I don't really want to consider that that's an improvement in the large scale, because they're coming to us with, don't look at anything outside of the area, we're just looking at what the impacts are at this local scale. So I think that we should just look at the local scale. That's from my perspective on it. My frustration is that we're really bound to the act and to the local ordinance, and that there's no wiggle room for things like plantings. I mean, when we ask the applicant, can you do plantings? No, because of this. Can you decrease the size of the road? No, because of this. And I understand that there are sort of logical, there's certain logic to the alternatives. And coming into the meeting, I was swayed by, you know, once they've done the due diligence of the basics that's required by the act, you have to follow through. But I'm frustrated that there hasn't been any kind of give and take about some of the issues. And I'm really surprised that there has not been any change since the beginning of the proposal. I mean, you would expect that there would be at least a little bit of change in the original proposal based on some public comments. But I feel like my hands are tied, because it feels like the project meets the basic minimum.
Meets the rules.
Yeah.
And if the commission feels that there are conditions that are necessary to ensure that the project complies with the Wetlands Protection Act, such as plantings, then yes, you're certainly within your jurisdiction to do that.
Yeah. One thing that I think we should put in there is just a consideration, an assurance that all of the water is actually, in fact, coming from stormwater, and there hasn't been any tie-ins from, and it's unlikely that there hasn't been any tie-ins from sanitary sewers or coming from houses, but there's always that possibility with a very old system that there's unknowns. But that would be, you know, something that they'd probably uncover along the way.
I think the comment too about the whole stormwater investigation that the city is going through, we need to be involved in that. I think that was a really good comment because we're coming in at the end of the process. It would be so much better if we had some input at the beginning of the process looking at, because all this is related to other stream flows and other areas of the city, I think we could have a broader conversation that might help instead of being stuck at the end of the line with what's...
Well, and I think that, yes, the comment you're referring to, from what I know, we're not behind other communities, but if we were to develop some principles, principles of design, principles of mitigation, principles of addressing the water quality before it gets discharged into existing river systems, that would be a valuable discussion to have. And I agree that if we have those as a set of guidelines that are in place, as people are designing and permitting and engineering these kinds of things, that would be a lot easier than coming in on a thumbs up or thumbs down at the end of the design process. But that's for later.
So Sarah, I'm struck by your comment about replanting trees in your report. Can we put in a condition that all trees that have been removed must be replanted somewhere within the watershed?
You could, if you think that's necessary to make sure that the project...
Or within yeah. Riverfront area.
No, definitely. And it doesn't have to be limited to this particular site.
Yeah.
It could be a larger watershed perspective.
I have an idea how much of the BMX trails are actually in our jurisdiction. Particular projects.
I think most of them.
Most of them. They're in the bottom, but I'm relatively sure. At least within the 200 feet. Mm-hmm.
So that would represent a good area that they could maybe reclaim or restore, which goes along with improving the site.
Representing improvement. It would require owner sign off, but I'm imagining that the owner would appreciate all the help we get.
No, because it's outside the easement.
Right.
Yeah. Must be some of the earnings.
Tricia, additional thoughts?
I mean, again, the issue of storm scepters was mentioned, and admittedly, they are of high cost, but, the concern would be further erosion and stabilization of the area. If that's, given the cost, is that an unreasonable condition?
I feel like it's a reasonable condition if they're going to create a permanent road that they will want to maintain. But it seems like you put in as strong a cleaning mechanism as possible. It seems like that's kind of logic I've been having in my head is that if you're going to do it right.
Right.
Rather than do the minimum and have a road there at the same time to maintain it. But I also feel a little bit constrained about that we haven't had that discussion about cost versus.
Right. Well, you know,
Yeah, I mean, the conceptual arguments in the alternatives analysis that the applicant presented was a sound conceptual argument, but didn't include here's how many dollars, percent increase in total costs, like you said. So you don't have those kind of details. But I don't think that, because that prevents us from including something in the order of conditions that makes a requirement that in the final pre-construction process consider those things. We could probably even, agree that if there were an overly onerous financial impact, that they could either come back to us or we could allow staff discussion. But we can put it in our order of conditions, and that if they make the case that's convincing to us that it's unrealistic, then we can make an exception.
Or they can appeal the order.
Or they can appeal.
So what's that option?
My conviction is that we all are on the same team, looking to accomplish most of my same things, and so we just have different sets of responsibilities. The city, in this case, has to do something with a broken system and not enough dollars to do everything that's necessary, and is trying to put together a good solution. And we can understand and sympathize and really support that, but at the same time try to steer it in a direction that fulfills some of our responsibility beyond the thing that Tim pointed out, which is that by the letter of the law, you guys put together a good, it's hard to say no. But still, we have judgment to exercise about the impact that it has on the resource areas that we're responsible for. So now we would have to make this into a motion. The thing that I've, and Sarah actually just looked at, did mention it in her considerations as well, is that the detention mechanisms and the cleaning mechanisms be made part of the design, and again, the applicant can come back and challenge that order. As a starting point, to assume that there has to be some cleaning mechanism, but you're not just taking the water out and dumping it in the river. The other question, I guess, is the width of the road. I guess I'm ultimately persuaded that there's got to be a road. Contractors aren't going to be willing to do the work without there being a road, and there's got to be a road. And we have seen failure elsewhere in the city of systems, and if you have to rebuild the road to get there when such a failure might happen, so I'm persuaded why the applicant maintains that the road should be permanent. I don't like it. I think it is a substantial impact in that quite small area when you're there and you look at that hillside and imagine that road coming down, it's going to be quite an impact. On the other hand, it is an actively eroding, difficult, steep hillside right now. And so it's going to be changing over time. This provides some stability. Um, 14 feet or 10 feet. One can argue, is it 110, 150?
150
feet.
you take 4 feet, you know, not that much, you take 4 feet off in terms of the actual compacted area, it's not that difficult, 600 feet.
No, what you have to really look at is the side slope disturbance. I don't think it's going to change that.
Which side off, where would the 4 feet come from? Yeah. You down there, right?
Well, you're still going to have a significant amount of side slope disturbance, no matter whether it's 10 feet or 14 feet.
Right. Yeah, that's where I came up to, in that it's the overall construction process that's going to be the signals.
So how do we handle this then? I mean, I will make a motion that we will allow an order of conditions, issue an order of conditions with standard conditions, and then we have a certain set of conditions that we're going to add on to those. And that's where, you know, we can't be super specific about some things because it depends on how they improve, for example, add additional treatment methods. And I think that I would propose that the additional treatment method must be included, but then to what level? And I'm just not sure how to phrase that. You know, we could say storm scepters, but is that really, you know, is that going to be that?
No, we're not in the process of redesigning their project, but you could just say it needs to be a marked improvement.
But there, yeah, to say that there should be an improvement in water quality from the time it's upstream as it's currently coming in, just going straight into the river. And so proposing what mechanisms might help to improve water quality, whether that's, presumably it's mostly particulate matter, things that would settle out and detention system of some kind. I think just say that we want to require that be to the maximum practicable extent, language that the applicant has used, included in the final engineering. Similarly, I would like to include to a more natural stabilization techniques, again, to the maximum practicable extent possible in the final engineering.
I'd also like to see a planting plan. I know there's steep slopes, there's a lot of riprap, but there are ways of milling around the area.
And we've done that with other applicants,
right.
Through the riprap and around the riprap have had success with getting plants established. So those are two special conditions for more natural stabilization, three actually, natural stabilization, planting plan, and
water quality,
all to maximum practical extent, and that is it. Sarah, is it worth including that we understand that this is an additional set of requirements, especially with the water quality, establishing what the maximum practicable extent is. We can either have a staff assessment, or we could say that come back before us before final construction begins.
The project is only subject to this
rainwater
standards to the maximum extent practicable, so there's not really a number we could provide for TSS removal, so it may be worth just having one more plan to come back to the commission prior to construction.
Good. Deleted, you have all this?
Yeah.
Somebody gonna make that as a motion with those additional conditions? I guess, Tim, you're
what about the trees? We haven't really talked about
the replanting
trees that have been removed. And that could be included at on site if they could come back with us with a planting plan, but my guess is that they're not going to be able to replace those trees. And I think we should
not
have...
Not in kind.
Oh, no.
Not in kind, no, right. But I think we should start to work with the city about how to improve the number of trees and their placement. And so if we... I would recommend, I would propose that we say that the city will replace all the trees that were removed within the riverfront area, within a certain area. I don't know how to define that, but within this
project area.
Yeah. I don't know if there's enough space to be able to plant that many trees in the project area. I don't know if we've done that much, but within the
site.
You know, I would consider that the map that they've presented us of the whole sort of area within which this is considered a watershed toward the Mill River to be a potential area for plantings.
Will you involve planting trees in the BMX trails?
That would be great.
I don't know, but I'd like to see some trees down there, or plantings down there.
Any standards for those trees? Minimum diameter, et cetera?
But they're appropriate native plantings within the floodplain, and they'll survive for at least 3 years.
Like we usually do.
And I think they should, if they're coming with a planting plan, then they should come up with a plan of where they're going to put those trees, whether on site, preferably on site, and if not, demonstrate whatever.
That's a good motion. Is there a second?
No second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? So moved. All right.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Thank you. We'll see you in
about 2 minutes.
Notice of intent for dam removal and stream restoration work to occur within the riverfront of the Roberts Meadow Brook on the bank and bordering vegetated wetlands and then subject to flooding. This is also DPW application, Chesterfield Road location.
Thank you, good evening. I'm Jim Laurel, I guess you know that from the last discussion. I've got some folks here with me this evening. To my left is Matt Taylor, he's a geotechnical engineer with GZA. To his left is Paul Davis, who is a principal environmental scientist at GZA. And to my right is Alex Hagman, who's our restoration specialist with the Division of Ecological Restoration. We have a brief presentation for you this evening to talk about the dam ecological restoration limited project application. I think because I've got some help here, we'll do the heavy lifting in the presentation. I think all I want to say about the project is that the city has been working since 2007 under a certificate of non-compliance and dam safety order from the Office of Dam Safety in terms of bringing this dam up to meeting the standards. The city decided a while ago that the dam breach would be the most cost-effective means of coming into compliance with the dam safety order. Since that time, we've worked with several other different regulators and applying for permits and determining an approach for this. The project approach that's described in the notice of intent was developed in collaboration with the Army Corps of Engineers, Department of Environmental Protection, Division of Fisheries and Wildlife, and the Division of Ecological Restoration. There's a number of dam projects happening across the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, as you're probably aware. Some evolution in discussions within the regulatory community about the best way to approach projects like this. And the project that we're proposed in the notice was based on valuable input from all the different agencies. And I think with that, I'll turn it over to Matt, who will talk about the dam condition and a little bit about the breaching procedure that will be used. Paul will talk about the resource area impacts, and then Alex will end up with a few words at the end. So I'll turn it over to you, Matt.
Thanks, Jim. Thank you, everybody, for the opportunity to be here and talk to you about the project. As Jim said, I've been working on this since 2007. GZA actually started working on it in 2006 when they did a dam inspection. The dam, I brought a few pictures of it, and I'm sure everyone in the room has been out there, has been classified as being in poor condition or unsafe condition since the 70s. And in 2006, when we were brought on board to do our inspection, we also rated it to be in poor condition. And the reasons for those deficiencies, for those condition ratings, are the deficiencies, which include the leakage through the masonry, the displaced masonry, on the right side of this board here is the top of the embankment dam, and it's a little bit tough to see until you get up close, but there's a large depressed area that goes around what is the core wall through the embankment, and what we believe that is evidence of material moving through the embankment and coming out through some of the leakage on the downstream side. This bottom left photo of the board shows the leakage coming out through the bottom of the training wall where the weir ties into the abutment there. We've done inspections as a requirement of the order from the Office of Dam Safety on a six-month cycle. We've also done four rounds of phase one inspections per the dam safety regulations of the dam since that time. And each time we found the dam to be in similar condition, there haven't been any improvements out there. We have noticed that there is a slow, gradual deterioration in condition. There haven't been any real obvious changes in its overall condition, but is by no means getting better, and you can see that things are starting to progress. The results of that 2006 inspection prompted the Office of Dam Safety to issue an order to the city to one, inspect the dam until it's either fixed or breached, i.e. brought back into compliance with the regulations, to conduct a phase two study of the dam to figure out some of the engineering parameters behind it, some of the hydraulics and the stability issues. And then also to ultimately select a approach to bring it into compliance, whether it be a repair or to breach. And our discussions have been leaning towards the breach based on a significant alternatives analysis. Fast forward to where we are now, after Jim explained, we did multiple rounds of pre-application meetings with multiple regulatory agencies, and we've come up with an approach for a dam removal that is considered what we call a staged dam removal. And the goal of it is to control the sediments within the impoundment during the release or during the breaching of the dam in a way that will protect the environment and give us the ability to control it and throttle it. So our plan is to take the dam down over about a 9-month period in stages, notch it about 5 feet, let the water level drop, let the sediments move within the impoundment, let the sediments move downstream throughout the channel. When that's happening, we're monitoring the channel. We're doing sediment adaptive measures to help encourage the sediment down the channel. There is a low area as you get onto Reservoir Road towards Middle Roberts, where it is relatively flat. We're afraid that if we let it happen too quickly, there's a chance that the sediment could get stuck there and cause flooding in the road. So we're gonna go with the staged approach. And during that process, over the 9-month period, we will notch it, allow the sediment to move, monitor it, evaluate if it's ready for another notch, and then take it down until there is no more dam left there. The contractor will demob from the site. He'll leave the site secure for the winter, allowing some ability to get in there if need be from an emergency standpoint. But then in the following spring, come back and do the rest of the site cleanup outside of the riverbanks, and then we'll be done. So that's it.
We looked at the topo lines, like there's maybe 12 feet of from the lowest part of the water, the deepest part of the water to the surface at this point?
Based on the bathymetry that's out there where the sediment is, but the dam is about 35
right,
feet
no,
tall.
I understand.
Yeah, right, right.
So how many notches, how many steps in the notching process?
We're going to vary it between 5 and 10 feet, so it could be 5. It could be less than that. It depends on how the system responds as we take it down.
We plan to capture the sediment with a four-way. I think it was mentioned in at least two documents. They were going to build a four-bay down at the middle reservoir.
And then earlier options included that.
Oh, okay.
The latest option does not have that involved.
So it's just let it form its own delta?
Yes. And that decision wasn't made just based on this was made with input from other regulators.
Yeah, I didn't know whether it was a requirement from those other agencies.
Yeah, we thought it would have been, but they felt that it wasn't.
Yeah, that was actually in their encouragement that we took that option off the table just because they felt it was a betterment to allow the sediment to distribute naturally within the stream itself, but also within Bill Roberts too. It would be lesser of an impact.
Well, yeah, you'd have to draw the whole dam down below.
Yeah, well, the depth of the Middle Roberts is obviously shallower at the upper end, so you'd be able to lower it to a certain point, dewater that end. Yeah. Construct the berm, build the berm, and then allow the water to come back up, and then use that for a four-bay.
Go through the whole process again.
So right, just be dredging from another spot. So yeah. We dredge, move it, dredge. So. Mm-hmm. So I think at this point I'll turn it to Paul, who will give discussion of the resource areas.
Yeah, I'll just mention the resource areas that obviously we're here to regulate. Be regulated within the resource areas because that's where the activity is happening, and also talk about it. I don't know if you've had other ecological restoration orders or conditions that are coming before the board, but it's kind of a new process now to guess to all of us. But we tried to structure the notice of intent application to run through all the regulations and explain how the project is in compliance with those regulations. So I'll spend just a little bit of time on that. You can drill down and ask any questions you want on any of the specific elements. So Upper Roberts is here. This is the zoomed out view here. Upper Roberts Reservoir is here. The dam is located right here. And then the Roberts Middle Brook continues down to Middle Roberts Reservoir along this area. Obviously, the business end of the work is going to take place right at the dam for the dam removal itself. But there will be effects on resource areas upgraded within the reservoir itself, which will be dewatered. And a new stream will form within there. And we show an approximate location on there based upon the bathymetry that we did. And then obviously then the sediment's going to be redistributed along here. As Matt mentioned, we will be monitoring that very closely and making sure that they are being mobilized to the extent they need to be, and they're not causing any impediments that might exacerbate flooding in this area. And then ultimately, a lot of them will redistribute to Middle Roberts. and either add to the benthos in that reservoir, or perhaps shallow out a few areas that might develop as emergent wetlands in that area. They'd still be land underwater because it'd be below mean high water, but it would potentially, I mean, low water, but potentially they might have emergent vegetation in there as well. Just real quickly. There are other maps in here in the set that talk about just the resource areas, but this kind of is a sort of composite that shows a lot of what's going on in terms of not only the resources, but also the work. So to accomplish the work, we need to get equipment to both sides of the dam and also below the dam. So we need to have a temporary construction access. That would come off Kennedy. Fortunately for us, there's an existing logging road that's there that's in pretty good shape. So we don't have to really build this thing, we just get to use it. But there are some wetland areas that are actually within the roadway itself. So we are going to cross those with logging mats in these areas, swamp mats, Colin, if you're familiar with those. So basically, they'll be placed down in place, no disturbance of the earth, and then removed upon completion of the work. So the crossings that were submitted under the, with the plans show it here right along the existing roadway, and then it branches off of this more prominent road, but there's an older road bed down here, which comes up in this area here. If you're out in the field walk, I know several of you were, that we walked on both along both of these for most of the way. And then the plans as submitted deviated from that one to have a crossing come onto sort of a peninsula of upland, another small crossing, very narrow crossing. And there, from there, you can access into the river, get below the dam, and then access this road would need to be cleared to get the trees out of it to get up to the dam. And then a small construction staging area over here would need to be cleared as well. There's a dike here, dam, and basically, as Matt described, this would be taken down in lifts, working from above and from down below. The material would be lowered into the bed below, knocked into place, and then removed from that location and brought out. The total area is being affected by this project. The types of resource areas being affected are bank, land underwater, those are the big ones. It's worth mentioning BVW in the sense that we are having some temporary access crossings here. Fortunately for us, there's really very little BVW along Upper Roberts, so we don't have to worry about dewatering the reservoir and having there be a secondary effect on BVW. There is one small BVW area that we identified up at the upper end, but really the water level doesn't change there very much because it's really where it's more stream than reservoir. And plus that wetland, if you look at it, it's really being fed by the bedrock leaching area. It's a quite dramatic topography there, so really is in pretty good shape relative to that. The total impacts then for banks that we identified are, there's about 3,600 linear feet of bank around the reservoir. Obviously, when we lower the water and it becomes a stream within there, you now have a new location of bank. And because it becomes a narrow or ribbon, if you will, of the stream as opposed to the broader reservoir, you do get a little bit of shortening of that. But overall, we lose about 100 feet, linear feet of bank with that. On the plus side of the equation relative to resource area, because reservoirs don't have riverfront area, but streams do, all of that area that was in the basin of Upper Roberts becomes riverfront area, in addition, a little bit beyond that. So there's actually quite a net increase in riverfront area at the end of the project. For land underwater, there's a net loss because of the loss of the reservoir, about 182,000 square feet of land underwater. But again, that's really compensated by a larger increase in the riverfront area. Let's see what else should I mention. Let's get into the Ecological Restoration Limited Project. That's a new one for us. It comes under 10534A. If you had a chance to review it, and we tried to be very specific about detailing, you know, how the project comes into compliance with that. And Alex worked with us quite a bit on that as well, because and help frame the way that that is presented to you, because he's had the fortune or misfortune of actually doing a number of these projects through the state already. But there's several things that need to be. You need to meet the definition of an ecological restoration project, which is in 1004. You have some general provisions that you need to meet. And then there's some minimal provisions that you need to meet as an ecological restoration project. And then there's considerations for your approval of this project as an ecological restoration project. So each of those three areas we hit in sequence in about a six-page section of the NOI. And just basically to summarize it, you know, we do meet the definition of an ecological restoration project. In fact, it's actually cited as one of the types of ecological restorations that can occur, dam removal, that is. There are protections for rare species. We have the fortune of not being in a natural heritage polygon, so we don't have regulated species in this area. There are some upgradient, but there aren't any right in the site itself. We have gone through the 401 process, that's a requirement, and we have received the 401 water quality certificate. There is a pending appeal, I think, as we're all aware, but we did receive it, which is a requirement for you to act on this. And then there's some other miscellaneous requirements as well, but basically they're not applicable to us because they're like the stream crossing standards or something like that. They don't really apply to the project. At the end of the project, we have made a commitment relative to providing trail access to this area. One thing that we mentioned, it's not specifically a part of this application, but it is referenced in the sense that there is going to be something left in the riverfront area right at the head of the dam. There is going to be some historic monumentation. We've been talking to the local historic commission, but really this is in the purview of the Army Corps of Engineers and the Section 404 permit. They are the lead federal agency relative to national historic of areas of significance, and this dam was determined to be such, and to be eligible for such, I should say. And as a result of that, they have to go through the Section 106 process, which requires coordination with the state historic office as well as the local. We've made some recommendations, and we talked to the local commission about what we could do for monumentation, acknowledgement of the historic nature of the structure, and reuse some of the blocks for historic or projects within the city, I should say. Also to provide some monumentation up at the top of the abutments, to retain the abutments along the side so that you can show that there was a dam there. It's not being totally naturalized, but it is being done in a way where, you know, you'd be able to see that, oh, there was a structure here, what was that about? And there'll be some signage up here that can be viewed by the public. Whereas right now this is watershed lands, not open to the public for viewing. The DPW has allowed that will change with this project. And there will be a trail allowed to be existing along the existing logging road and also following the new road that's been brought in here. And this will be allowed to stay as trail. Obviously, it's going to narrow down. The trail is not as big as what we need for equipment. But the crossings would just be kind of plank-type crossings, like you would see on any kind of trail-type setting.
Is that part of this proposal?
Yes, it is.
Okay, I'm sorry, I missed.
Yeah, so that's.
I mean, the trail itself, the construction. Of the
trail. Yeah, and it basically it's in the same location. We do have a separate map that shows that at the end of the day, because although we're taking out the timber mats and all that kind of good stuff, which we need for construction access, obviously you don't need anything like Herculean for public access afterwards. So we're doing much more simple, you know, block and plank sort of thing for public access. When we were out there on the field walk last time, and this has been submitted to you secondarily, but it didn't appear as part of the initial submission of plans. So it's a little bit different in terms of, you do have it, and it has been submitted to you into DEP. But we have proposed, based on the field walk, a slightly alternative access, which on the face of it doesn't make sense, but it actually does make sense. It actually, for temporary wetland, the BBW impacts, it's actually larger, which doesn't sound good. But when you think about what the impacts are and what the trade-offs are, you might want to consider it as approving it as an option that we can use. And I'll talk about that a little bit later.
The access would be the same coming in up to this point. But when we were looking at it, when we come in, we originally was going to drop down here and come across here. When we look at it, we're taking down a lot of mature trees right in the riverfront area, existing riverfront area. If we come in here, there's a remnant of an old logging trail here in it now. They had a crossing. It wasn't very developed. It was, you can't see really a road. But you look down and there's no trees, at least 20, 25 feet wide swath. So we can come in along this swath with virtually no tree impact at all. We have to have a turnaround, so we need to take out a few trees here. Likewise, the existing road comes in and it really goes right along this alignment, right up to about here. So even though we did flag this as BBW and it does qualify, it has hydrology, it has, you know, some vegetation coming up, it's, you're very clearly walking on an old woods roadbed. And the only thing you've got coming up for woody vegetation is kind of whips of saplings like this high. We had to kind of go this to walk through them. So with using the bog mats along this section, really that's, it's really temporary impact of it in a true sense where you're not taking down any mature trees. And I put a table on here in terms of what we're saving in terms of trees. And we're going from a removal of 42 mature trees in the buffer zone in the riverfront area under the original proposal down to about 14. So the significant saving is on trees. If we do it that way, on the downside, there is an increase in the BBW temporary impact. But given that it's temporary, it may be something you wish to consider. Now, if you can consider that, if we move to approval, I should say when we move to approval, what I'd appreciate, just because we have not been able to get, it hasn't been entered into the 401 and 404 process yet for this alternative, if you could approve it as an option, maybe even a preferred option, but an option, as opposed to eliminating the original proposal, because we're not sure where we're going to end up with those approval processes. I think this would be everybody's preferred way to go forward. And, we kind of think the other agencies will agree, but until we talk to them, we don't know. So with that, I think I can be quiet and turn it over to Alex.
Okay, so my name's Alex Hackman. I work for the Department of Fish and Game, Division of Ecological Restoration. Good evening, thanks for having us here tonight, and good evening, members of the audience. I'm here to speak first in strong support of this project, and then also to focus my comments on the ecological benefits. I want to talk about why dams are bad and why removing it is such a good thing. The benefits of this project, in fact, are so great that in 2014, we accepted it as what we call a priority project, which is a formal designation for a handful of projects every year or two, depending on our capacity, for those projects around the state with the highest ecological benefit. So we get approached for a lot of help removing dams, and we take a small subset to dedicate technical services to and direct funding to that have high ecological value. That's the case here. I've been assigned the point person since that April 2014 acceptance. I'm an aquatic ecologist. My background, I have a specialty in sediment management, and I've led or been part of 17 dam removals so far. So my group has done 40 dam removals, so we have a lot of experience doing this kind of thing. We've been able to fully participate in the engineering design and to comment on some of the measures that Paul just discussed, for example, to limit the short-term impacts involved with the demolition of the dam. You know, although we've only joined this effort relatively recently, obviously we're aware that this is a long-term effort. We've been at this for quite some time, and obviously we're aware that there are some voices of opposition in the community. You know, my hope tonight is to speak directly to some of the environmental concerns that I've heard have been raised by some of the opposition. I'm not sure if anyone's here tonight that has made any of those, but I'd like to speak to them regardless, and then generally describe the ecological benefits of this project in plain language. We can talk technical, but my goal is to talk in plain language. Okay. So I want to start with the basics with dams and river systems. So when you put a 30-foot high wall in a river like we have here, you fundamentally alter the natural ecosystem. Dramatically bad things happen to a native stream ecosystem. Now, some may point to the pond upstream and say, well, there's this well-formed pond upstream, that's a good thing, that should be protected and preserved. I've even heard that from, I think, on our walk. To that I would say, thank you for raising your voice in support of Mother Nature, I appreciate that. she needs that help. And I would say that, those good intentions are misplaced. And that is a reductionist view that does not take into account the larger system degradation that happens from that wall in the river.
Just for procedural purposes, we ask that you address the commission.
Oh, sorry.
Thanks.
Sorry, thanks.
Thank you, Jim.
The most obvious impact with a dam in a river is fragmentation of the native ecosystems. Streams are long, linear ecosystems. They rely on the free movement of energy, materials, and organisms, primarily in a downstream direction, but also there's some upstream movement. When you build a dam, you fundamentally disconnect. You fragment the habitat. Instead of one long stream, you now have stream, pond, stream. What lives there doesn't live there, doesn't live there. There's no talking. Nature's not talking to each other. It's fragmented. Okay? There's some very obvious impacts that we're all familiar with. There's a lot of focus on fish passage, right? Fish swim to the bottom of the dam, they look up at the 30-foot wall, they can't go upstream. And indeed, fish passage, the restoration of fish passage is a big deal on these projects. Here you have a beautiful forested watershed, it's great cold water. As we experience warming with climate change, fish are gonna wanna go up there, seek thermal refugia in the summertime, have access to critical spawning areas and so forth. So fish passage is eliminated when you have a wall in the river. As the water slows down behind a dam, you have a domino effect resulting in poor water quality. As the water stagnates, it's exposed to the sun. There's, of course, no shade because it's a big pond. It warms, dissolved oxygen levels go down. In this case, that warm, low oxygen water spills over the top and affects the downstream reach water quality as well. I will note that we have a study that's ongoing with UMass Amherst right now. I have seen some of the provisional data that came out of the work last summer that suggests that is an accurate statement here as well. It's cold, high DO, dissolved oxygen above the impoundment. It warms up, it goes down in the impoundment, and then that negative effect is seen downstream of the dam as well. I can try to get that data made not provisional if the commission would like to see that. In addition to the water quality degradation, when water slows down, some other more subtle things happen, but they're critical to the long-term health of the whole system. One is that all the leaves drop out, or many of the leaves in the organic matter drops out and settles in the pond bottom. Those same leaves are key to the downstream food web. They feed the microbes, the microorganisms, the insects. Other insects eat those, fish eat those insects. That's your skeleton, your stream food web. This is all summarized in the children's book, Trout Are Made of Leaves. There's other types of organic matter that drops out in the pond, larger wood that would flow downstream and help form habitat. All drops out behind this large wall. And this is the case here. Importantly, in slower moving water, along with the leaves, sediment drops out. And you have a degrading effect on the downstream habitat. It's a condition below dams that we see all over the state called, and actually nationally and internationally, called sediment starvation. If you look at the stream bottom above the impoundment in the woods, it's a beautiful stream of different grain sizes. You get below the dam and it's like this. It's mostly boulders. The water has washed away whatever was there and it's been starved of that natural supply of sediment that comes downstream, and over time, that's what builds habitat and maintains it naturally in interaction with the wood. So it's wood and sediment and water that build stream habitat. All that's been starved by the presence of the dam. Of course, the floodplain's also submerged upstream, one of the most dynamic parts of a natural landscape. And in this situation, you may have another really neat feature, a gorge that's been submerged. So dam removal addresses all of these impacts immediately and permanently with no future maintenance required. The stream can then take care of itself. It's for these reasons that my office uses dam removal as a river restoration tool, that we prioritize it. We're working on about 30 right now around the state. It's for these reasons that DEP streamlined the permitting process for dam removal specifically. And it's for these reasons that we strongly support this project. In closing, I would like to speak to the larger issue of change itself. I think that we encounter this in quite a few communities that are experiencing the prospect of dam removal. When confronted with change, especially to something that we see in our everyday lives, change can provoke fear or anxiety. It can seem like change is only going to be a nightmare, something different. What I'd like to do in closing is just try to leave the commission and the audience with a different perspective, one that actually is a dream instead of a nightmare. In my time working on these projects, I've had the great benefit of standing in a river and watching fish swim upstream while the excavator is still in the water. Just miraculous pace of recovery. I've seen the mud upstream on the former impoundment. Everyone worries, is the mud, is it gonna be muddy or stinky? No, time after time, what I've seen is that mud quickly turns into green. There's so much seed, nutrients, and when exposed to sun, boom, it explodes. So you get to witness the miracle of rebirth over a condensed time frame. In the downstream habitat, I've seen how influxes of sediment quickly and permanently improve habitat. And in fact, there's a wonderful project just across the valley in the Pelham Hills that if anyone's curious to go see, an amethyst brook. Sediment was released from a dam, a previously terrible condition downstream habitat immediately changed. And this is what will happen here. Downstream of this dam will fill with sediment. It will look crazy. And over time, with storm events, the finer materials will wash away. The gravels and the sand, gravel, larger grain sizes will remain, and you'll have a very different stream bottom habitat than you have today. Across the valley, Amethyst Brook, what that meant was 5 months after the dam removal, we had sea lamprey coming up to that area for the first time in 40 years because of that change in benthic habitat. And that's so fast. That's just 5 months after the dam removal. So here that might take a little bit longer. We are acknowledging that there's going to be a short-term physical impact to the downstream reach. We're also saying to you and to the public that that transitions to a permanent and positive benefit. So our sediment management plan, which these guys alluded to, involves this release. We do not view there being any ecological risk to that. And in fact, fishery staff agree with us, all the regulatory agencies agree with us on that. There will be this temporary physical smothering, quickly transitions. Our downstream adaptive management is entirely based on mitigating or trying to avoid infrastructure impacts. As ecologists, we're not worried about this material filling downstream. We are worried about flooding the road, and that's why we have the adaptive management steps in there. Okay? So, in closing, the dam removal is the start of the restoration. It's not the end. It's a disturbance event that jumpstarts nature and sets it on a healing trajectory. And I'd like to invite the commission to embrace this dream, and also members of the audience and public. You're gonna have the chance to witness this rebirth in your own backyard. It's a very special event. The project's been designed for very small footprint, use of existing roads, the use of best practices to limit impacts. And I think that's about what I have to say. So I'm open for questions with a focus on the ecology, if you'd like. And thanks for your time.
Thank you. Anything else? Questions from the commissioners? Why don't I see what the public would like to offer? Yes.
My name is Julie Kling. I live at 47 High Street in Florence. I'm also an attorney with the office of NJ McLean Offices here in Northampton. I represent the group of people known as the Friends of the Upper Roberts Meadow River and Chesterfield Road Dam. I helped create that organization nearly 10 years ago. I'm representing this organization at no cost to these people. I have looked at all of the documents. I have looked at the notice of intent. I would like to make this comment about some of the studies that GZA has presented to us. The bathymetry was done in 2008. That was some years ago. I'm not good at math, but it's what, 7-8 years ago, considerable amount of time ago. The calculations as to the amount of sediment in this reservoir are based on that study in 2008. So it sounds like all of these regulatory agencies, and there are many agencies that are, there's a plethora involved here, local and state, who are all working with numbers from 2008. There's an estimate of 27,000 cubic feet of sediment in the reservoir in 2008. There's an estimate that only 10,000 is going to so-called sluice down through the dam and down the brook. I believe that there is considerably more sediment in the reservoir, and I brought someone who's going to speak to that issue. There's a lot of sediment, a lot more sediment, that when it does sluice down through, it's going to obliterate the existing cold water fishery that's there now. And it's going to dump all of the sediment down in the middle reservoir, which is a backup water supply for the city of Northampton. So I'm concerned about the amount of sediment that all of these agreements and these orders have been based upon. As far as the ecological restoration or ecological issues, the GZA studies of the actual sediment that is in the reservoir state that the sediment closest to the dam are the finer particles and the organic particles. And the particles that are the larger sand and gravel size are at the input of the reservoir. When the water is lower, or the dam is lowered, and the water moves over, the finer particles are the particles that are going to go down. Those finer particles, to my understanding and my research, are the kind of particles that are not conducive to a cold water fishery. In fact, they are the sort of thing that destroys an existing cold water fishery. Temporary, perhaps. I don't know how temporary it is, because we have a lot of material that's going to be moving down the brook. It seems to be more material than what has been presented as fact by GZA. They have done some studies since 2008. They were out in 2014. The casual observer can observe that the amount of sediment has increased dramatically in that reservoir. So I have some concerns about the amount of material and the particle size of the material that's going to be proceeding down the river. And I'd like to call on my fellow friend, Wayne Thiebaud, who can speak to that. I'd like to approach this in a collaborative. I know you're nodding, sir, but you called me the opposition. Collaborative effort to try to resolve this issue that the dam presents. I understand that there is a nationwide movement to restore cold water fisheries, to take dams down for that reason, and I understand what the background is for that and the reason for doing that. We're talking about a very small area. We're talking about an awful lot of money for a small cold water fishery that I think is going to be obliterated, and I don't know how long it's going to take for it to come back. So, Lynn, if you could speak to your what you've observed at the reservoir.
My name is Wayne Thiebaud. I live directly across from the reservoir. I've been there since 45 years, 1970. And always observed the water levels and so forth, and seen the drastic change over the years. When they started building up in West Hampton, started logging. And I remember back in the very early 70s, I called the water department because I noticed the color of the water being all turning brown, and it was because of all the building and so forth and everything. Well, I've been involved in this from the start, checking things, and what I've really observed in the last few years is I could see the bottom of how the pond filled in, and I didn't know how deep it was behind the main channel of the reservoir. So what I did is I took the bathymetric survey that was done by GZA in 2007 and looked at their average depth and where the silt was. And then I got a hold of a couple of friends. One's Joe Masterka, here's tonight. And I have 8 years of background in survey, so I wanted it, and it's the first time I've been out in that water. I basically went out and took a 100-foot tape on a pole, and we measured things. I had a hand laser for distances. We marked all the stations. In other words, I wanted to have everything like basically like GZA did, every 50 feet roughly, going up and checking and recording basically where I hit the bottom. And I plotted all this after, and I noticed a few things. The actual island that's shown upstream there, one of the other prints, has grown drastically, and it's probably when you're on the land side looking, there's only a 20-foot channel there. And a lot of their survey goes 1,400 feet up the brook. I noticed from roughly
a little over 1,000 feet up the brook, it's filled in where there was little pond areas, and it's anywhere from 6 to 12 inches deep, average. Down by the dam, where we took depths, I basically looked for deep depths, and we recorded the distances, and I found, after I plotted everything, that roughly the amount of sediment changed anywhere from 2.5 to 3 feet more sediment on average compared to their profile, GZA's profile, which amounted from the, if you take the 27,000 cubic yards back the GZA shows on their print of 2007, it came out to about 40% more silt. And I've been down there, I go down there almost every day, and a lot of it depends on how the sunlight hits it, where you can see how deep it is in places. And basically the whole pond area is filled. There's a narrow channel, comes down. I plotted roughly where that channel was, and I compared it with GZA, and it changed a little bit, but then it's probably, you know, you have 7 feet, 6 feet all along the pond area, a little narrow channel. And from where my mailbox is, going down 400 feet to the dam is basically where the depth is. But even all that changed roughly 3 feet. And when you look at, I went down and I checked below the dam and where this flows to the next reservoir. It's a man-made channel, it was made in 1924, I believe, when they changed the brook itself. The brook was all relocated to get down to the Mill Reservoir. The Mill Reservoir was built 10 years after the Supper Reservoir dam was built. So this stream that comes from that dam down to the next dam is man-made. It's got stones on the side for riprap, and I discovered there's at least three areas along there where it's partially washed out, and where you turn, where the stream turns on Reservoir Road, it's eroding the bank in there. It's really never been really maintained, and you talk about trees getting in the upper pond and leaves, well, that's all full of trees down through there. And plus broken branches and so forth. And if that water level changes roughly 3 to 4 feet, there's areas where it can flood the field down there. There's two other wetlands that come in there that are low, where this water, once high, feeds in there too. Now, when we had the hurricane, I was down at the dam, and when I look at how they're going to take this down in sections, if you ever had another big storm, I just want you to visualize. The dam is 70 feet across. And as you come up the head wall, where you're standing above, I've seen 70 feet across, 3 to 4 feet high wall of water. How would you stop that water as you're taking this down if we had a major storm? All that silt and everything is going to wash across the road, in wetland areas, in a farmer's field, and so forth. So I don't know how that's really going to be controlled. And as far as the fish section of it, yeah, you got a nice brook coming down. It's in the pond. You got a different species of fish, and you have different animals and ducks and so forth and everything, and otter. But when you go below the dam, you're going through a man-made structure. It isn't a natural brook. It's man-made. Down to the next reservoir, you have a dam there, and a dam below the a beach area, another dam there. And then from there, it goes down to the Mill River. And I know back in the 70s, when they were talking about taking the dam down, it went before the Conservation Board, and I know back then, it was
they didn't want to let that silt go from there down to the next reservoir, because it just, eventually, somebody's got to own up to it, up to that silt. It's going to be carried over, it's got to be removed sometime, if you're going to use the backup reservoir, or it was even mentioned that it could be carried over to the Mill River, which basically ends up down at Smith College where they got to pay to dredge it. So there's, I understand the trout part, but I understand there's other fish, and there's other animals. And the thing is, the data, being that it's been going on for so long, all the data that's out there is basically, it's changed drastically. There's less water and a lot more silt. And I'd just like to have that be considered. Thank you. You're welcome. Anyone else? Sir.
Yes. Well, I'm Joseph Mastorka, 312 Chesterfield Road, live about a mile from the dam. Have been watching the dam for approximately 40 years. And our issue now, like, we're opposed to taking out a dam, but that's not what we're talking about. I have 4 points I'd like to make. One was, we mentioned briefly the historical mitigation plan, which is mentioned in the application notice of intent. And I just would like to add, that is the same plan that was submitted to the Historical Commission, I believe it was in June. And at that time, they said that this was the first step and we're going to have some discussion. I don't believe that discussion ever happened. I happened to go to the next meeting and was discussing some alternatives to that, and they said, now is not the time. So I was a little bit surprised to see that they're submitting the plan before without any additional discussion. And so I'm just mentioning that. The other one, and excuse me, I did not get your name.
Alex.
Please
address your comments to
the commission. Yeah, but I just was going to say, Alex mentioned, when he's talking about ecological restoration, he said, stream, pond, stream, and where the pond has these detrimental effects, which I agree with. I don't disagree with anything he has to say. In fact, I belong to several organizations that are interested in taking down dams. I'm interested in saving this dam. And I don't see it as being hypocritical or anything else. The reason I think what I would change Alex's thing when he said stream, pond, stream, I would say stream, pond, channel, reservoir. So the restoration of the channel, it's really a man-made riprap channel, which I'm sure can support fish, but it's now is a mess, and it is filling up with silt. When I first read sedimentation starved, I couldn't believe that they were submitting this to the thing. That's, I think, out in the Colorado River or whatever. But the fact of the matter is they have used that, and that channel isn't sedimentation starved. In fact, it's filling up. And earlier in the process, when they rated this dam as high hazard, and representative from ZGA are here, and the dam safety rated as high hazard, the reason it was rated high hazard, because I don't think anybody thinks that dam is going to have any catastrophic failure or is going to fall down immediately. But they rated it because of the public road downstream, reservoir road. And it seems ironic to me that what you would be doing is adding silt to the channel, which would increase the flooding of that, of the road and the whole floodplain. I had calculated before Wayne and I did our own bathymetric study that the water in the dam would have raised the floodplain less than an inch and a quarter. After seeing how much less water there is, it's probably certainly less than an inch. But the fact of the matter is that where that sediment is going to enter is into the channel, and it's the channel, and we're talking about restoration, ecological restoration. If you looked where the original stream was, if you're going to restore that, that would be a restoration. We're talking about a man-made, straight as an arrow channel. And so let's see, like the last thing I was going to say. Oh, The thing that surprised me most about this hearing, and with all due respect to Alex, when we're talking about restoration, and I was in the Department of Office reading, I'm not quite sure if it was the Army Corps of Engineer 401 or the 404 plan, but at some point they were talking about restoring the stream. And I went to Jim and I said, geez, I don't understand this. It's not making sense. And I thought they were talking about restoring the channel. And Jim corrected me. And he said, no, they're talking about restoring the upstream of the dam. And that's like the restoration. But nowhere did I hear tonight talking about what the restoration was going to be. And I would like to add, because I've been opposed to this dam removal for 7 or 8 years, I think, if I remember correctly, the original plan was they were going to have coffer dams and they were going to pump the water out, they were going to dry the silt out, and they were going to truck it out, and there was going to be regrading, landscaping, removing all the invasive species, planting native ones, and grading it. And I said, geez, to myself, I said, geez, that's going to look beautiful. This plan, I don't think they're doing anything with the silt behind the dam except letting the stream, as Alex said, cut through it. But now we know that there are some places where the silt is 13 feet deep. So it's going to cut through that channel. And I believe the power of spring, you see it every year, the power of these leaves coming out, and things are going to grow. But you're still going to have, there's more silt in there than you previously thought. In fact, I think it's 43% more, which is significant. And that channel upstream is going to continue to be unstable and continue to take silt from upstream to the channel, the man-made channel, and plug it up and cause more flooding. And so I am part of the appeal to the permitting, and it's based on the amount of sediment and all the studies and all the permitting that go from that, the conclusions they have drawn. I think that they may be incorrect because of the large amount of sediment which they have not taken account of. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes.
Hi, my name is Amy Singler. I live at 516 West Hampton Road. I drive by the project a lot because I'm not all that far. I also work on rivers and river restoration for a living, so I work on these kind of projects a lot. So I've actually been sitting in these meetings, but at the table presenting projects as well, so it's kind of full disclosure. I guess I'll comment on sort of the resource impacts on this kind of project, and we haven't done one of these projects in Northampton, although there certainly have been a lot within this area of Massachusetts, but I work up and down the Connecticut River watershed across all four states. Which is just that relative to some of the impacts, when we're talking about DVW and we're talking about land underwater and then restoration of riverfront area, again and again, as Alex mentioned, you know, there are these temporary impacts. It doesn't usually look pretty when it's happening. I'm working on a project in Connecticut right now, and it's messy as it's going on. But we know that what we're doing is we're having those kinds of temporary impacts to things like reduction of land underwater, but we're getting an increase in riverfront area. And we know that long term, because we've seen the benefits of these projects over and over again, that we're having a temporary impact, but we're having a permanent impact, because what we're doing is we're restoring a self-sustaining system. And that's always what I think is one of the really exciting parts about these projects, is that we know that we've permanently allowed the river to be a river again. Alex and others have spoken to the impacts of these kinds of projects. And yes, there is habitat there, and what will be there later will certainly be different. But what we have is we have a system that can maintain itself, that doesn't need to have impacts go back in again to sort of keep that system going. And one of the things I think is exciting about this project is my understanding is there's a really fantastic healthy population of slimy sculpin upstream, which is it's not state listed, but they are, so it's not state listed rare, but they are not common, I should say. So they don't have a listing, but we don't see them a lot. And they're a species that I often say are poorly named because for something called a slimy sculpin, they're actually really fantastic cold water indicators. So there's not a lot of places in the state where we have a really fantastic population of slimy sculpin. Obviously that population has to stop somewhere upstream of the dam because of the impacts of that reservoir. And when we talk about, and we think a lot about climate change, and we're talking about resiliency of systems, and we're talking about the kind of impacts, and we think a lot about connectivity and the ability to create connective systems, because when we do have impacts from high flow events or from drought, the ability to have a larger, more connected system, the benefit of that is that species that move, that they either move upstream to seek refugia from hot or cold events, or they may be washed downstream, or sometimes we have populations that become fragmented. And the more connected a system we have, the more resilient that system is in the long term. Anyone who knows Scott Jackson's work over at UMass does a fantastic job really talking about these issues. So for me, both, I mean, professionally I work on this kind of stuff, but it's really exciting for me to have this happening in a community that I'm working in. And a place that I drive by all the time, and to know that that's something that we can kind of give the river back to itself, and really kind of give the river back to the fish and the wildlife as well.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes.
Robin McKeown, 35 Rust Avenue. I have a bit of experience with similar projects and with the Wetlands Protection Act, but I'm interested in this project primarily as a resident of the city. Seems to me the city and the state have identified the need to address failing infrastructure, and the state, as well as state and federal regulators, have identified the benefits of dam removal and sediment mobilization, as Alex has described. So from my perspective, the project appears to be an appropriate approach to managing infrastructure on part of the city, as well as meeting both the letter and the spirit of the Wetlands Protection Act, including the recent revisions to provide a pathway for projects, dam removal projects like this under the Ecological Restoration Project pathway. So as a resident of the city, this is a project that I'd like to say I support.
Thank you. Anyone else? Questions from the commissioners?
I saw that you mentioned somewhere that this likely would increase BBW, or that there would be wetlands associated with that. Was that what kind of thinking is behind that?
It's just we're going to be obviously recreating the stream channel upgrading.
Yeah.
It's going to be going through soft, somewhat organically enriched sediments now to create the riverbank and what's going to form there. So we're not really sure how much riparian wetland may form in there, but we're expecting that some will. Mm-hmm. Close to the dam is, as Alex was describing, it's sort of like a gorge, what will become a gorge, rather. Further up gradient, it's a little bit flatter. So up in those sections, we might get some bordering vegetated wetland adjacent to the stream. It's really hard to predict. We don't know. So our estimate was purely based on, okay, if we got 20 feet on either side, how much would that be? If we got 10 feet on either side, how much would that be? So we came up with a guesstimate, and it's only a guesstimate, between 6,000 and we say 12,000 square feet potentially, but we honestly don't know for sure, and we're not making a guarantee that we'll get any, but we think it's logical that we'll get some.
Just to add to that, the estimate takes into account the width of the upstream channel, the width of the downstream channel, kind of puts that through the impoundment, so that's the free-flowing river that's now going to be restored in the flat areas on the side of that. That's our where we're estimating the BBW.
Is there, if indeed there is 40% more sediment than you originally measured, does that affect the way this project would function, or do you just extend the amount of time, or do you have to take the steps down more slowly to allow the, what would change?
If the numbers are accurate, the project is designed to monitor the removal of the blocks and what the impact downstream is. So if there's more sediment or less sediment, it's somewhat irrelevant in terms of the process, because it's one that's designed for observation and feedback. When we remove a lift of the dam, we look at what the downstream effects are, and then we make a judgment about when do we remove the next series of lifts, and whether it's a 5-foot lift or a 10-foot lift of those blocks. So.
So the process might take longer, but it would be essentially the same process?
Could potentially take longer.
Just to add to that quickly, I said this before, but just to reiterate, the downstream sediment management is based on risk. So ecological risk, infrastructure risk, human health and safety risk. We don't view the sediment management approach as having much ecological risk, regardless of the exact volume of sediment. It's going to clean itself out with storm events anywhere from a few months to a few years, which is a blink of an eye for nature. The potential risk we think is to the roadway. That's where the adaptive monitoring, adaptive management plan comes in to help jostle the sediments and scoop them down to the mill reservoir, and they'll make a nice delta wetland, and if necessary, to remove some of them and put them on the side of the road to dry and remove later. So.
I think it's also worth noting that early on in this process, as you mentioned, it started more or less in 2007 or so, when we were doing the MEPA documentation, we made the point when we were considering the potential of possibly retaining the dam, what that would look like, when that was considered as an alternative. We basically made the evaluation and the statement at that time that the pond was filling in with sediment. So it would have surprised me more had there not been an increased retention of sediment over this period of time. It's entirely keeping with expectations, and as it's been stated, it really doesn't change the process of how you would remove the dam or what the impacts would be. The volume is pretty much irrelevant.
And the procedure for which the dam is taken down, we still have that ability to react because the sediments are shallowest at the upper end of the reservoir. So when we peel off that first layer, we'll see that sediment move, we'll get a feel for how it's moving, and in effect, the dam will act as a sediment trap. So we'll have kind of an ability to see how the system's gonna function, and then we can use that as our benchmark for how we're gonna go down with our next set of lifts. If the sediment was right up to the face of the dam and we pulled it off, we would have no mechanism to control it, but by having the sediment higher at the upper end of the reservoir and deeper at the dam, that'll catch it and will give us some time to evaluate and modify as needed. And modify may mean keeping the notches open longer, it may mean increasing the size of the notches. It's kind of a nice system in that we're allowed to have some flexibility and we can react to the way that the system responds.
Just to set commission expectations, you know, after the dam is gone, there will be additional sediment mobilization as the channel finds its form. Mm-hmm. You can take a very prescriptive approach to setting the form of the stream, or you can take more of a nature knows best approach and give it a little time. And as storm events roll through, the river finds its course, those initial eroded banks lay back, floodplain benches develop. But that's what I was talking about before when I said some patience is required for expectation setting and to let the system evolve on its own. So there will be some bank erosion that happens. That additional downstream transport is part of this, and it's just fine.
And that applies even to the man-made straight line channel?
No, this is only above the dam. Above. That's where it's gonna, you know, obviously convert from a pond back to a free-flowing river. That's the area of real river restoration. I don't think anyone contend in this group that downstream as a channelized incised reach is impaired. And gosh, it would be wonderful to put it back in the original channel, but I think that would probably be a couple million dollars worth of culvert work, and I think that would be a great project, but it's not part of this project.
Other questions from commissioners? What's the area that's drained by the Roberts Meadow River, do we know? Bob Newton from Smith just talked about 55 square miles for the Mill River. That all ends up in Paradise Pond. All of that sediment for 55 square miles upstream, which is what they're trying to do now, which we permitted some months ago, is instead of dredging every 5 to 7 years, to stir the water during high flow events and have some of it more naturally distributed downstream. We'll see whether that works. But dealing with sediment in river systems is. Once humans decided to take up residence among the rivers, something you have to do.
But they didn't end up, and it was in the MEPA documentation, and I don't have the number off the top of my head, so rather than guess, get it wrong, I'd rather say no, I don't know.
You know, you're forested there, your watershed is generally forested, lightly developed, very beautiful watershed, obviously water supply watershed, well protected. Doesn't contribute a lot of sediment. You know, if a lot of development happens, you get a lot of forest clearing, that kind of thing. These are the waves of human activity that contribute a lot of sediment to a river system. But as it is right now, it's pretty nicely protected. Wouldn't contribute a whole lot.
Mason, you look thoughtful.
No, I was just basically worried about the sedimentation downstream. And I thought at first that it was going to be a four-bay situation.
You thought it was going to be what?
They are going to have to construct a four-bay at the middle dam to grab the sediment and get rid of it that way. But the more natural approach actually makes more sense, as Smith College is finding out.
Trying to see whether it works without filling in their picturesque pond in the middle of the campus.
Right. What's the capacity of reservoirs down the road to allow the sediment to move, or is it really just going to settle in the next reservoir down? I'm just having a hard time knowing of the scale of that, the scale of the amount of sediment that's going to be resuspended, and then where is it going to end up?
We actually, I think I can point to it. We did have an estimate of that area. It was based on the 10,000 yards, so let's assume that it's more. But, so if it's 43% higher, if that number happened to be accurate, let's say it's 14,000, so we can kind of estimate, maybe what that might look like. But let me get it. I think they have a few other reservoirs. So this is a little bit from memory, but we actually had a polygon sort of estimated for where that would sort of look like, where the preferential deposition would be for that. And at that time, we were looking at putting in an impoundment of some sort, like the turbidity curtains, or maybe even at one time we were looking at a structural dike that we would temporary, we'd put it in, take it out. But that was a while ago. Anyways, that was sort of in this area here. Okay, so the preferential deposition would be sort of in this area here, and there's plenty of depth and bathymetry, which we do down there as well, at least the limits here, which would accommodate that volume. And still you would have it be open water. It wouldn't become, you wouldn't see a delta there. Now there might be some delta formation. The BVW here, if you look at it, and the topo isn't quite detailed enough to show it, but you can see if you stand on the banks of the road here, you can see there's a little bit of delta formation here now. So probably there'll be an expansion of that in this area where you can see a shallow delta below water, but still a shallow delta. And that might be an area where you start to see emergent growth coming through with time. Not necessarily a bad thing, because that has water quality benefits as well. But probably the submerged sediment, which is most of it's going to be in this area here. You know, sometime in the future, if the desire is to keep middle reservoir as a reservoir, that water body might need to be dredged, like, or reconsidered how you mobilize sediment, just like Paradise Pond. Or, if it's not being treated as a backup water supply any longer, and there's a political will and money to do it, we might be able to remove that dam and do even more interconnectivity. But that's a future project.
The discussion of the capacity of the middle reservoir to hold the sediment and sluice down there was been part of our discussion with the state federal regulators in developing the final sediment management plan that was permitted in the 401 water quality cert.
One other point about the sediment, and that's when we did our bathymetry, we did probes, so we pushed rods down through the sediment to find the hard bottom. So that's how we created our hard bottom profile and topography. And when we sampled the sediment, we found it to be, in many cases, interbedded layers of sands and leaves, intact leaves. And that's a function of where they're being deposited in that large water body. So when those sediments are exposed to river flowing flows, those leaves are going to be dissolved, broken up. So the actual quantity that is measured in the impoundment is actually probably going to be quite less as it moves downstream because of that breakdown of the organic matter that's in there. It's not just silt and gravel. That organic matter is going to change form.
It's also, there's a lot of trapped gas in the sediments in Upper Roberts Reservoir.
when I did the, I was one of the people doing the bathymetry, when you poked holes through it, you would release trap bubbles, and they actually, because we were doing it every 10 feet, in every 50-foot transects all the way up the reservoir, you could actually see your transects for about a week and a half after I punched the holes, and you could see the bubble streams coming up at each location. So there was a lot of trap gas in there.
Organic.
Yeah, if you could harvest the methane, we could have a...
Other questions from commissioners? Chair, any comments?
I mean, it's just that it's our first crack at an environmental ecological restoration limited project, so it's sort of a new animal, but I think the applicant did a good job.
Well, it's a new animal.
Of outlining.
Most of us, not necessarily for somebody who's looking statewide at these kinds of things.
I should mention there is an invasive species control plan in there, so take a look at that. But I didn't talk about it specifically, but we do recognize it's an invasive species on the Alluvial Island, and it has been mentioned that's at the outside of the reservoir.
We had mentioned that when we were on the site.
Yeah, and we will be tackling that before we pull it apart, because we don't want to be the seed source for the reservoir audience. So, but, you know, an invasive species after that is going to be a wait and see, what's happening.
Just one more point from this end. Ideally, we like approval for both access routes. In our field walk together, we looked at the site, we said a contractor was gonna come here and say they wanted to do the alternative we submitted to you. It's easier, existing road, less tree clearing. We all looked at this in the field. So ideally, we would gain authorization for both this evening as part of your approval, just to be clear.
And that's 30 plus trees compared to 14 of similar diameter?
We would save about 30 trees.
You save about 30.
By my estimate. I field walked both alignments and I looked at what would have to come out likely to support those alignments. And it looks like we'd be net ahead 30 trees if we took the alternative that followed the existing roadbed, even though that's some of that roadbed is BBW.
Well, Mason, Jack, and I were on that site visit, and you had on the site.
Yeah.
You had some low, woody shrubs that you would have to clear about, as not as many of the mature trees. If no more questions, motion to close the hearing?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? And so the hearing is closed. Given that we're heading toward 9 o'clock, we've been at this for 3 hours. If it's acceptable to the applicant, I'd actually recommend that we digest all of what we've been hearing and defer action until our next meeting. I don't know if that's acceptable to the applicant, and I'm not sure how the rest of the commission feels. We haven't had a lot of these so far 3 hour plus meetings recently, but I'd like to try and limit it to as close to 3 hours as we can.
What, go ahead, Tim. Well, I am wondering what it is we need to discuss and how long it would take.
That it might not be that lengthy.
I'm just knock it off now or not. And one thing I don't know is what do we need to evaluate in terms of accepting this as an ecological restoration limited project. I mean, it seems to me that as I've looked through it, appears to meet the criteria, and I'm willing to check off on that, but maybe I'm not.
So the commission would need to find that the project meets all the criteria outlining the regulations, and then just development of any conditions that think appropriate.
So if we, does anyone have any, what other folks think about?
Well, there's standard conditions on the access road. That's pretty standard, right?
Yeah, in terms of the development of the access road, yeah. The, sedimentation and erosion controls, all that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe we can...
Well, that's what I'm asking. Is there, what is it that we need to... discuss. I'm not thinking of any additional conditions off the top of my head.
Well, there are the two options. Go with the, presented us two options for the access road.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure they're both in there.
Are you, so I unfortunately couldn't make the site visit. Do you have any concerns about either access road?
Actually, I like the second, the one that they mailed to us later.
The one pager.
Yeah.
It's more upland and it's a little away from the river and it is line of sight clear. So
it's, yeah, it's a lot less clear that they would have to be.
My overall sense is that the, although as Sarah says, this is a new animal, we haven't faced one of these before, but from what I am able to read, that it does meet the criteria. That our goal in defending and protecting the eight interest in Wetlands Act is well served by dam removal in general, and I think in this case I think we have to look at it in context that it seems like it is a plus for this section of the river and might in future years there need to be a downstream self-address after but I don't think we can say that because there are dams downstream that this doesn't have merit in its own right. I think it does. And I think that that's, I've read in the last couple of years three different works about dams since the colonial days and the impact that they've had ecologically and in species. And that it seems like none of this is entirely consistent with what we're charged, what our responsibilities are to support these kinds of initiatives. I think that this one does look like it is well thought out. I'm a little surprised that there wasn't a need to actually address sediment removal rather than just love. But it seems to me that, that as Bob Lindy was saying when we were talking about doing that mobilization process at Smith, that's what the current state of thinking is, that this is worth trying. It's the way nature's done it for millions of years. Let's see if we can help it in some ways. Instead of just shunting it off to the side and loading it in trucks and taking it somewhere, let's see what nature can do with it. So all in all, I'm inclined to say, this does meet the criteria for the sort of thing that we want to approve.
In terms of the local ordinance, this is an exception. It's allowed.
It's a limited project. It's a limited project. We allow disturbance in the protected zone for limited projects.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody have other thoughts? I'm sorry, you're not feeling well.
No.
Thanks for sticking it out here. Anyway.
Well, we need a quorum, so. I mean, I think it makes sense to move forward. I don't know that we need a lot of other discussion.
Okay.
Well, I make a motion that we issue more order conditions, finding that this is meets the criteria for the ecological restoration limited project, and that we would prefer the second option for maintenance unless there is a strong opposition in the future decision-making body. Yes, I don't know how to phrase that.
Permitting anything.
That's my feeling.
Because the lower route certainly could be done, but it wouldn't require, just look and you see there's a lot of 12 to 16 inch trees mm-hmm. that have to come down.
So can we approve both routes and then have a preference for the, the new alternative?
And as Jack indicated, the standard conditions would address the erosion controls and so forth associated with the construction and the temporary impacts of any other conditions that we want to put specially? Sarah, do you have any recommendations for that?
Can
your staff report it?
Some of it doesn't really apply. I think the standard conditions are considering
the trail construction. That's part of this project too.
There is a plan for the trail for both alternative accesses. Whichever one you choose would have the trail associated with it, but there is a plan sheet that shows that.
Mm-hmm. We're just going to convert part of the whole road to the trail, so there's no.
It's all part of the submissions form.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. Who's in this?
So I'm sorry, and I might have zoned out with my congestion, but so if we prefer one route, why would we approve both?
It's already been approved as part of the water quality certification, okay. And it's gone through the MEPA process with the first group.
Right. It's just,
we can't say we changed our mind.
Well, it's just that if we don't get it approved, I'm sorry, is it okay if I talk? If we run into a snag with 404 or finally with 401 after the appeal process, and they don't, if they say no, we approve the original access, you're going with that.
Okay.
We would have to come back to you if you only approve the one access.
This is the kind of thing that happens as these projects move through permitting. We have a requirement to provide everyone with a final design plan set once all these changes from every agency's made. And a change like this is likely administrative. It's not a big deal.
So we have a motion that is stated by Tim. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Just a second. Further discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So voted. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank all of you for your input.
Thank you.
Oh, but since you're here, that's okay. Not sticking around.
Thank you very much.
I was going to make a motion.
That's what I was going to ask Sarah. The yellow wall I was saying was, I can't imagine.
Unless they want to do
signing and leaving.
It's kind of like you go to join the Rainbow Beach, the guy who wanted to go to camp on Rainbow.
Yeah, they're kind of.
Sarah goes to like
that. She went to get a sheet. Is there anything urgent that we need? We still have a core petition.
Oh, we do?
Yeah.
Four.
Actually, don't we only need three?
No, because we have an even number. Oh, is that true? We're down to five?
Yeah, we're down to five.
I guess we only have three. So is this the double line? Excuse me, we have a little more business to conduct. If you could either be quiet or move along so we can do that. Next item on the agenda is proposal to allow wilderness camping on Melville Island.
So just quick background, the commission sort of conceptually approved the idea of this a few years ago as part of a paddler's trail, but we didn't have any more details at that time, so these are a little bit more details.
Yeah. Okay. My name is Kristen Sykes. I'm the Director of Conservation Strategies for the Appalachian Mountain Club. We have an office in Amherst, Massachusetts, and I live in Florence, Massachusetts, and I'm the Southern Coordinator for the Connecticut River Paddlers Trail. It's currently a 280-mile trail that exists in New Hampshire and Vermont. It's primitive campsites every 5 miles, so basically the idea is that you could paddle from
the Canadian border, roughly, New Hampshire, all the way down to the Long Island Sound. Yep, through Old Lyme, exactly. It's really lovely down there. You get the tidal influences. So my interest in this is that the Appalachian Mountain Club has been paddling on the Connecticut River and its tributaries for over a century. Actually, we helped develop the J-stroke and paddling in this region. So we have a long commitment here. We have a couple of chapters that are impacted by the river, the New Hampshire chapter, Berkshire chapter, and the Connecticut chapter. So we're working with the Connecticut River Paddlers Trail, which has developed 280 miles of primitive campsites, mostly working with local land trusts that have decided they have this great waterfront property. They want to make it more accessible. And then I'll just also say that part of this came out of the Department of Interior designated the Connecticut River as a national blueway a few years ago, and I was part of that effort to get the blueway designation. And so part of this was to increase more ability for people to get on the river, especially further south. And I actually paddled the Connecticut stretch, so all the way down from Enfield down to, well, actually we got Fish and Wildlife gave us a ride down to the Sound. But as you probably know, there's not a lot of access. Some of the areas we're talking about are very urban, and Alwell is pretty urban as well. But we have some great folks that work for the Appalachian Mountain Club up in the North Country who have been doing a lot of work to consolidate use. And so part of our effort is to get more access for recreation, especially for people to camp 1 day, 2 day, a week, the whole thing, which could take about 2 weeks. So to give more access. And then also to take areas that have already had a lot of impact. We've been talking with the Kestrel Land Trust about Mitch's Island, and there's a lot of camping right there because people just quite frankly don't know who owns it, and they've been camping there for a long time. So it's also a restoration project as well. So it's going down, and we've seen that after a few years of education, be able to consolidate the use, then it actually really impacts the area in a positive way of really being able to disperse the camping. So it's not just like people, you know, ride their boats, they set up shop. You know, we would have 1 to 2 tent platforms. We would have about 10 people that would be able to stay. It would be first come, first serve. So our goal is actually to be able to have campsites every 5 miles. So if you were paddling and a campsite was full, then you could paddle to the next spot. We're also working on access points as well, so making sure that people just have the ability to get down to the river, and whether it's fishing or, you know, stand-up paddle boarding, which we're actually doing on the upper part of the river, and I think we should do down here as well, get more young people outside. So Wayne and others at the city had approached the Connecticut River Paddlers Trail about this as a possibility. We are currently working with Mass DCR on 2 sites right now, in Montague and Whately, so those are kind of our pilots on the Massachusetts stretch. And we just got approval from the town of Whately to put in a moldering privy, which I don't know if you're familiar with, but you know, it's a pretty low maintenance way to be able to make sure that waste is contained. And also we have a MOA with DCR to be able to have people come out probably like once a month and make sure that, you know, everything is as it should be, to clean up. We're contracting with a fellow that used to work for the state who's into native plants, and so not only would we be getting rid of invasive, but we would also be planting native plants as well. So that's pretty much the story. So we're working on those 2 campsites in Whately and Montague. We hope to have them built in the spring, and so we're just looking a little bit further south of, you know, how we can be able to get more people out on the river. It would only be hopefully paddler accessible. You know, sometimes it's a little challenging. I know this part of the river has a lot of motorboats as well.
Often has had power boats lined up throughout the whole Connecticut, the riverside, not the little canal side, but and you know, people would park there and you know, from Friday night to Sunday night. And so I don't know how you're going to limit it to paddlers.
That'll be one of the challenges.
Where were you thinking?
I actually, quite frankly, don't know Alwell that well, so I would defer to Sarah.
Probably the northern tip. It's sort of, it's the clearest, it's the least buggy. Probably would make the most sense for people.
Has the least amount of semi-permanent campsites.
So are you looking to put in any infrastructure, or just sort of?
It would be very minimal, so it would be a couple, if needed, platforms just to like reduce the impact on the land. The moldering privy, basically the structure that kind of sits on top, so it doesn't disturb like below the soil at all, and everything degrades kind of in the cribbing. Probably a picnic table, although that might, I don't know, I've heard those disappear sometimes. Maybe you can put it on a powerboat and take it away. So it'd be pretty minimal.
And would there be an effort to limit this to paddlers?
I mean, would there be signage that says this is for, I'm thinking of the main island trail that is only available to minor members. And,
I mean, I guess that's, we kind of have to cross that bridge when we came to it. When we looked at the Whately one, it's right by the ball fields off of River Road, is we looked at an area where you could kind of take a cove to get into it. So the idea is to try to make it so that it really is only paddler accessible as opposed
to powerboats. Well, that's true. If you came at it from just around the corner.
Yeah, so I think we would try to make it so, we would try to help lead the use to what's preferred. So if we made it so that you really could only get there in a kayak or a canoe or something
if
like
it were,
that.
If it were on that shallower side, then powerboats definitely would be able to get to it.
So what's the connection? Is there a connection with the what they're doing, the crew?
The Northampton.
Yeah, the rowing. That's close to the...
Yeah, I mean, it's all increased access to the river. I don't know that they specifically tie into each other, because that's more of a day use, and this is long-term.
Right.
But it's all related.
What do you think?
I think it's a great idea. Absolutely. I would want to see a proposal for specific, you know, if something was going to be put in structurally, I think you should come back and talk to us about what that looks like.
Right.
But I think
see the
concept, I think that's great.
Great.
Okay. So I could come back with, I mean, it's not going to be much of an amendment, but amended language to our land use regulation.
I was just going to say,
And then just with the understanding that if you're going to be putting in any infrastructure, just to come back and let us know what that's going to look like.
Yeah. Right. We'd have to approve anything that's going to be cited there. So just to give us a design to look at. But what you described, 10 platforms and a pretty...
And I forgot probably a kiosk which tells you about the river and tells you about leaving a trace. And, you know, a lot of it is about
educating,
you know, people how to utilize the river in some of these places. So, yeah.
I didn't know there was a paddler's trail.
Yeah.
Are there any wildlife on the island that we need to protect? Are there any species habitat?
No, the tiger beetles south of there. Nothing.
Poison ivy.
Yeah.
A lot of
invasives.
Here comes my summer plan.
Isn't there a proposal to
We did some work, and what group? There's a group whose name escapes me that is planting blight-resistant chestnuts.
Oh, really?
Oh,
they're light-resistant chestnuts.
Restoration Society or something.
Oh yeah, are they like Chinese or something?
It's their sort of hybrid.
Okay. Cool.
That seems like a good idea, and I like the concept actually.
I think it's great. So this just requires to change the regulations.
Yeah, now they say that camping isn't allowed except for wilderness camping with written permission of the commission. But I'll just add camping at OL as far as the paddler's trail.
Great.
And I'll bring that next.
And it may not be enforceable, but let's say that available to human-powered craft, just so that if you're
putting
signage up to that effect,
you
have the force of our regulation behind it. It's not just your preference.
Right.
No ladder construction between the bridge.
A zip line down the aisle from the bridge.
Right. There you go.
So there's a lot of people who set up shop in the right along the river anyway, so it'll be good that it's on the island. So
right.
A lot of that.
Yeah.
There's a few people.
I heard there was.
Make your way over there.
Yeah. And I mean, part of the issue is people are doing the whole river anyway. They're just stealth camping, so this is trying to codify some actual places that they can go to in there. And we're also going through the FERC relicensing process on the upper part of the river in Massachusetts to get a few more campsites. So this is kind of part of a puzzle. We're trying to put all the pieces together and utilize all the tools we can. So
good work.
Thanks. Great. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
And I know it's a late hour, so.
Any other permits or mail, Sarah?
That's it.
Vacation.
Okay. Motion to adjourn?
I will adjourn.
All right, and our next...